I'm Nancy Allen, the principal harpist at the New York Philharmonic. The harp is a very complicated instrument, and most people see it as a heavenly, sort of ethereal instrument. But actually, it's really complicated because a lot is going on with your hands and your feet and your brain. We have to control the sound of the string with our fingertips and only our fingertips. So we not only play, but we stop the sound physically with our hands and our fingertips. And then our feet are controlling all the chromatic half steps of the instrument. So there's a system of 21 slots at the bottom of the instrument. I'm trying to remember all the time where those pedals are, what key I'm in. There is a story about a conductor looking back at the harp and saying, "Harp, louder, more pedal." Which obviously is someone who doesn't know anything about the harp, because our harp is controlled by manpower. Every instrument has a sweet, perfect range, and that's probably for the harp right in the middle of the strings. But that's not to say that we only play there. One of the techniques we use to be a little bit more precise in sound and articulate is French près de la table, which is close to the board. Playing close to the board makes it easier to hear, it cuts more through the orchestra. And we play very close to the sounding board, which eliminates a lot of the resonance. We also play harmonics where we cut the string in half with our hands. It's a very pretty sound. And that's used in a lot of orchestrations of Ravel, Debussy, all the people who were making colors with their music rather than just statements. The harp has a lot of strings, 47 in all, and they're different materials. The bottom of the harp is wire wound around wire. They're very strong. The middle of the harp, or the basic playing area of the harp, your fundamental sound is drawn from the gut strings. And this is the same gut as tennis racket gut, but it's much more refined. And then the top of the instrument sometimes has some nylon strings. And they all blend together, but the sonority of each color is very different. The orchestration books list the harp in the percussion section. The reason it's there is because it interjects music within the scores often. There are some times when Fauré or Debussy use the harp as an accompaniment, and you hear it all the way through the music, and you hear sweeping glissandi, which are when you just run your fingers over the strings, and you set the pedals in different harmonies. So that's the one unique thing that only the harp can do. We can make chords, and that's really unique. We are the only person that can do that in the orchestra. In Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique, he opens the ball, a second movement, with two harps, and everyone's waiting. The orchestra's tremoloing, and the two harps come in. It's beautiful music. Only the harps can make that kind of a sound. I love animals, yes I do. I have had a lot of animals, but I particularly love horses, and I always loved horses. All girls are enamored with horses, and I've heard that all girls are enamored with the harp, but I never had a chance to be enamored with it because it was right there in the living room. Horseback riding rivaled playing music, but I had a harp at home, so the harp overtook the horseback riding. But to this day, when I cover my harp, I always pretend I'm covering my horse. I found it to be so connected with harp playing because there's so much going on that's similar, and that is with the hands and the feet and the legs. So I just find them both to be beasts in a way, the harp and the horses. That's something that you have to learn to control, but you also have to respect them, because at any moment, if you have one wrong pedal, you are a fool on the harp. And if you do one thing wrong on a horse, you could cause an accident. Thank you.
Welcome everybody to our wonderful interview with, wonderful guest. Mainly that's the most wonderful time which we can have on Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. And today my big pleasure is to welcome Nancy Allen, who all the videos really nicely introduced her already. So I think that you know very much about her already, even you have known already before. So my big pleasure today is welcome our really star, Nancy Allen, the principal harpist of the New York Philharmonic. Welcome, Nancy. You are here. Hello.
This works.
To see you. It works. You are wonderful. Thank you so much for all these videos and all this what you have done. And of course, it's my big pleasure that you also made time for us to make this interview and to be with us. Nancy, how are you?
I'm fine. Thank you, Jana. And what a pleasure, first of all, to see you. I haven't seen you for 3 years since Bloomington. And you look as beautiful as ever. And I must say that I am incredibly impressed with what you are doing for all of us. I don't know how you can fit this into your schedule or figure out how to push the right buttons and make this happen. But you know, in my lifetime, I've never really looked back too much, except towards my daughter. She knows I tell all my stories, but I've never really looked back at my life. And I moved last year from a big house, where my daughter grew up. For 22 years, and I put everything in boxes. So when you said, "Do you have any photographs or videos?" I had to really organize and find and go through my life and find things because I've never done it before. Actually, life is what happens when you're busy doing other things. That's what John Lennon said, and that's what I've been doing, and all of us have been. But somehow you fit us all into your life, Jana, and thank you for that.
Oh, I'm so pleased. You can't imagine how happy I am that actually you also found some things which you maybe have forgotten already and that you can come back and maybe talk about, you know, and we all are really so excited to hear all your stories from your life because it's so incredibly rich. And I would really like to know, I know that your mother was a pianist and organist, your father was a drummer and photographer as well, but how did it come that you played the harp?
You know, I've heard all my life stories from young people that they love the harp, they saw it and they always wanted to play it and they dream about it. And that really happened in an unusual way because I didn't really have a choice. My mother was a pianist. She went to Columbia and she studied piano with a teacher at Juilliard, but she was really studying to be a music teacher, public school music teacher. She played all sorts of instruments. Had to play a little bit of every wind instrument. So what she said to me when I was young was that you have to play the piano first, which she taught me, but she never had time to teach me because she always got coffee during my lesson. So I learned to sight read very early and she gave me everything to sight read from, you know, Broadway tunes to chord changes to simplified Beethoven to hymnals. And I learned to play, to learn to read on the piano. And then, the story was that when she was in college, she lived in a dormitory because all fine girls lived in a dormitory in those days. They wouldn't get their own apartment. And next door to her was the woman who played Blanche Birdsong, who played in Phil Spitalny's all-girl orchestra. And that's the truth. And you can look them up. And she was in big dresses. And they all were great musicians. But at that time, women didn't really have careers. So my mother would see this harpist bringing the harp in and out, and she just became enamored. And she said, when I have children, I'm going to have them play the harp. But she also felt that you had to play another instrument, a single line instrument. And since I was a terrible singer, and so was she made me pick an instrument, and they just chose it for me. They gave me my aunt's old oboe, a Loray oboe. And from the time I was 7 years old, I gave the A in orchestra until I was 18. And I learned my first Mahler symphony, Mahler 1 on the oboe, badly probably, but I really played and I took lessons and I loved learning because I still can't sing. My daughter makes fun of me. But my father, on the other hand, was not a trained musician. He was a jazz player. Mm-hmm. He was a drummer. He was actually by profession a photographer. He took a lot of pictures for medical photography. So he took a lot of publicity photos when I was young, but they all looked like someone was about to operate on me. plastic surgery. That was his field. So my mother would say his photos are so unflattering because they were so clear. And I would say, can't you just diffuse it a little bit, or I could brush my hair? But his nighttime hobby and his real love was music. And he would develop film and pictures. That's what you did then. You didn't just click on your camera, on your telephone. And he would develop the pictures, and he'd have chemicals all over his hands. And he'd lick his fingers and get the chemicals. And he'd say, don't touch it, because it'll ruin your calluses. And he said, every time he picked up a picture, he'd show me the face appearing of some famous person who was having some plastic surgery done. I can't name them. And he would say, thank God you're a musician. Lucky you. And so, but he played the drums at night, and he played in a jazz band. And I learned all about jazz and big band, but mostly big bands. And he wrote love songs and his organ. And indeed, he was in love with a lot of other people. So that was his little secret, was the book. But I loved reading his love songs. So they both loved the harp, and they just brought that harp into the house. And my older sister started it first. And then I really was enamored with it at that point. And I asked for harp lessons with a teacher. And I played something for her that I made up. And I had my head on the wrong side of the harp. And she said, well, that was okay, except you have to sit on the other side. And then my younger sister started also. And there it was. So I always loved the harp, and I loved the piano a lot, but I wasn't good enough. I'm not as good as a lot of my students who play, like Catherine Siochi plays fantastic piano, or Adam Fan now, or many of them. Siobhan, again, he's fantastic piano. I love to play the piano when I imagine that I'm really good, and I play Schubert, easy Schubert and Brahms. But I take that from my mom. Thank God she gave that to me, because I love piano repertoire.
Oh, that's why actually all your music which you are playing, as we have heard also that you play the Debussy, you took also the piano music. Is it your like hobby to use more piano music at the moment?
Well, I've always played the piano, and I always loved that repertoire. And my friends all along in my life, my colleagues and my girlfriends and boyfriends, were musicians and of other instruments. So I learned their repertoire. I had a lot of cellist roommates. I had violins and percussion. And I learned half of my education from those people, from my friends, about how to play. But Mr. Granchetti also loved transcriptions. And he encouraged me, because he said, he's famous for his quote of saying, in his story about his article about transcribing for the harp, he said, they didn't have our harp, but we have their music. So he made me feel very confident about playing anything that I wanted to play. And so actually, I have transcribed a lot. I haven't published anything, because I've been too busy playing and raising my wonderful daughter, who helps me a lot. And my daughter taught me actually how to play a present rev that I just played. She plays a cello, and I've played it with her so many times. I don't even have a video of it. She plays it so beautifully, and I accompany her, and she just tells me if I'm too fast or too slow, or if I played a downbeat too soon, or I didn't hold something long enough, or I didn't crescendo. She's a real bossy cellist. Oh. I mean, she's beautiful. But she taught me how to play it. And then I've always loved this pianist, Percy Grainger. Percy Grainger, actually, he was born in Australia, and he came to America, and he died in 1961. There's my daughter. Very good.
I just did not find it. So sorry for waiting a little bit before I found from the picture that it's her. And also, I have some comments from her. She's with us, so it's very nice. And I'm so thankful that here's another picture of you, of course, together.
Well, that's her bird, Cuckoo, who also teaches us a lot about singing, because he repeats everything we play. But she taught me how to play a present rev. Thank you, Claire Marie Solomon. But I love Percy. I wanted to play it by myself, because she left. She's 27 and she left home, and I can't get her to come home. And I've been here these months by myself. She did visit me for a few weeks, but so I love Percy Grainger. And he was Australian, became an American citizen, and he died in White Plains, about 15 minutes away from my house now. And Percy Grainger was a great pianist. He wrote famous Country Gardens, which I want everybody to play on the harp, because it's so cool. But But he used to travel around in the early 20th century around Europe, and he would record on one of those old Edison phonographs. He would record folk songs, and then he would transcribe them for the piano. It was sort of like Bartok did, you know, but Percy Grainger was a great pianist. He later became a professor of piano at NYU, New York University, where Bridget Kibbe teaches. And he transcribed this. He also taught at Interlaken for quite a while, piano, and he played recitals there. You can look him up online, Percy Grainger. But he did this transcription, and I've always had his book of transcriptions, and also he wrote a lot of reels and things like that, Irish music and English music. But when I heard this arrangement, I said, okay, when Claire's not home, I'm going to play this. And I played it a lot. And on that recording, you see, this is all done with my cell phone, which is right here. I can't believe that it actually recorded it. But I was really, really sad about a few months ago. I mean, everybody's sad because we're just locked up in our lucky homes. But I was really sad the day that Lynn Harrell died, the great cellist Lynn Harrell, because I grew up with Lynn in Aspen, and my daughter did too. She sat on the stage when he played Don Quixote. She was about 3 years old, and she sat next to me on the floor on a blanket. And I said, shh, because I've got a big solo coming. And I played in the first page of Don Quixote of Strauss. I play 5-1, you know, 5-1 chords. And she looked up, I said, shh, it's a solo. And she looked up and she said, you call that a solo? So anyway, when I play that, I think of her. But I, on that day, I was quite sad, and I was diffused with the light of my windows here. And I just did it once, and I said, that was for Lynn, because he taught me so much with his playing during many, many years in residency in Aspen, a beautiful player. And he also is a native New Yorker and lived quite near me in my hometown. Yeah.
Oh, what a really, in memoriam, a wonderful, wonderful performance. Really, I'm so glad that you shared it with us and that we could have heard it. And before, we will also interrupt our interview with the music, because we have so many music today. We have so many videos of yours. So I would like to, of course, share all of them. I would like also to share the comments, because we have already so many comments, and I would like to thank everybody who is there. So of course, very quickly to go through, we will just, so, from Veronica, Grace is here. It's we have from some people, I have no idea. Of course, the name is, and here's your daughter. and here are some other, and here is also, and here, and we have also here big, we will come to it, big message from your daughter, which is really nice. We should read it. One time her dad's photographs got mixed up in our family photos. Thanksgiving, we were all looking at all slides, bracing ourselves, because every other photo would be open eye surgery. And this,
they're laughing at each other.
There's a conversation between them, but I just would like just to go, this is nice here. Thank you for taking time to do this. It's really my big pleasure. And I'm so, of course, happy to have such great guests as we have today. So, and now I will bring some videos. Would you be any which you would recommend me now to use?
Well, it's up to you, because I'll tell you whatever you tell me, I'll talk about.
Maybe I will put the Hasselmann's Nocturne now. Is that okay?
Perfect. You can put them all together if you want. It's up to you. Okay.
I think we will have a lot of thought that we will do it separately.
And Jana?
Yes?
The reason I like these pieces, these four pieces that I recorded yesterday, my daughter put them together for you in honor of you. Is that I always find that some of the harpists are afraid to play the easier pieces, which I don't find easy at all. For me, everything is difficult, because as soon as you can play the harp pretty well, you want to play it better. So I love the early pieces of Hasselmann's and Ibert and Zabel, because musically their compositions were so great, and lyrically also. And sometimes we're so busy playing clumps of notes, like in the Four Impromptu or the Ginastera or, you know, or the Rodrigo Concerto, that we don't actually get to play a musical line. So that's mm-hmm. why I chose to play these pieces for you.
It's really wonderful. And I'm so really, I have to tell to everybody, I'm so glad that we have these videos. I just apologize. You have seen that I had to cut it because the program doesn't allow more than 100 megabytes. And of course, the videos are much bigger. So I have to divide it. So I'm sorry that there is always a little cut between and it's not continuing. But after we will finish our interview, I have also downloaded the whole complete concert of Nancy, which we are posting now on the YouTube. So as soon as the video of the interview finishes, which will be in a couple of hours, I will of course post also the complete concert of Nancy, which we are now seeing, not really totally complete.
Yeah, Jana, this was yesterday in my bare feet. Mm-hmm. I still have bare feet. And I was yesterday in my hot living room. And so it wasn't really a concert. There was no one here except for my parrot that you saw mm-hmm. on Claire's head. That's Cuckoo. But he's locked up in the other room. I told him to go to bed so he'd be quiet.
But it's a beautiful. So enjoy. Now we will have Nocturne by Hasselmans. Thank you. Yes, it was beautiful. Bravo again. Thank you. I just wanted to say that this was recorded yesterday for the Harp channel. So I'm really very pleased. This is absolutely like a live concert for us. And I'm so honored that it has been done by our wonderful guest today. Nancy, thank you so much and bravo. We have many of them who came a little bit later. I just want to inform we have many of the videos. So today's interview is always belongs by to the talk and to the music, which is great. And Nancy, I would like to know, who was your first teacher for the harp? Who brought you the hands on the strings? Because your hands are so beautiful. So just who was the first one?
Well, first of all, I spent a lot of time teaching, and I've been teaching for years, and I'm only beginning to really learn how to play the harp. But I look at some fantastic hands, and the hands that come to mind are beautiful. You know, I could name them for you and also say hello to my past students who might not even be here today. But I think of so many people like Marie-Pierre Chevroche, Nicolas Tullier, Annie Talbot, beautiful hands, Catherine Siochi, Emily Levine, Stacey Shames. I look at their hands and I go, oh, I wish my hands like that, because my hands don't look like that. But I do keep my thumbs up, and I have arthritis, but I get through. You can see my terrible arthritis, but I play through the pain and I'm fine now, and I'm gonna keep playing. But I have very high thumbs, and that came from my first harp teacher, Marian Bannerman on Long Island, because she didn't tell me much else except to keep my thumbs up. And so I think I learned that. And then I went to, after Marian Bannerman, who was a student of Salzados at Curtis, I think at Curtis, she was on Long Island where I grew up in New York, and she had a big harp studio, and a lot of people studied the harp as kids with her. And then I moved away, and Samuel Pratt, who worked at Lionel Haley, his wife was a harpist, Rosalie Pratt. He told my mother that I could choose two teachers in the area where I was moving, and that would be Pearl Chertok, who played with the NBC Orchestra and played a lot of jazz, or Lucia Lawrence, who was famed wife of Salzado and brilliant. And Pearl was closer to my house. So my mother chose Pearl. And I was lucky because I could have been in either one's hands, but it took me an hour as it was to get to her house. And she was a hands-off teacher for me. She wasn't that way for everybody, but she let me be. I don't think she ever told me a thing about my technique or a wrong note. She'd have a glass of vodka in the other room. She'd say that was beautiful. Before she died, she said, never forget how to play softly. She said, just promise me you won't forget that, especially when you're playing Scarlatti. And anyways, I loved playing with her. And she was great because she sent me everywhere. And she took me to Israel when I was 16. And I passed the first stage somehow. And I remember that's where I met a lot of my idols of the harp world. You weren't born yet, but it was in 1970. I was 16 years old, and I heard Catherine Michel. I wanted to be Catherine Michel. I wanted to be Martine Gilio. I wanted to wear her red coat and be her. I wanted to play like them all. Chantal Mathieu, Ayako Shinozaki. I said, Miss Shinozaki, what became a lifelong friend? And I said, What piece is your favorite on the program? And she said, well, the Bach G major pièce en sol of Rainier. And I said, really? She said, yeah, it's the best music. I said, oh, okay. So I kept that in my head my whole life, that if Ayako said something, that was the truth. And so anyway, that was Pearl as my teacher. But she sent me just before, after high school, just before I went to Grancheny, she made me go to Lily Lasquine in Paris, who was just all about music, nothing about technique. She just listened. She taught me how to play the Ravel. She taught me Spohr variations. And she also, Pearl Chertok also sent me to an Italian teacher in New York, Mario Di Stefano, and then ultimately to Grancheny. And that was something I intended since I was little. I wanted to play for him. And he was my teacher at Juilliard. And what a gift to be in his last class. I say I'm the last student of him. I truly was, because he came to a Hindemith Sonata in Tully Hall at Juilliard, a Juilliard student concert. And he walked down those steps, which was hard for him. It was a mid of winter. And he went to the hospital after that, and I never saw him again. And so I've always felt like that was my last lesson. And
how long have you been teaching, studying with him? How long?
I had him 3 years. Almost 3 years. But I played for him before that when I was younger. And then, of course, Jane Widensall became my teacher because she was assistant. And Jane Widensall taught me everything about early music. I was very lucky. She taught me, she made me write out trills. She made me write out transcriptions. She endorsed my love of Couperin and Rameau. Handel, she made me play the F major Handel concerto, not the B flat. She made me play the F major. She made me take my F major CPE Bach sonata of Grosjean and put it in my bookshelf and made me learn the G major that she was working on as her doctoral program, then her doctoral dissertation, the G major, the real thing. Mr. Grosjean's was F major and we all played it. And I had to, I had to just like close my eyes and ears and just change into one step up and a completely different piece. And then Miss McDonald came. I felt like that was just incredible gift to have Grosjean, then Jane, and then Suzanne McDonald, which I never dreamed I could be in her studio because she was on the other side of the continent. And so I had Miss McDonald for until I graduated through my debut recital, and that was pretty great. And Miss McDonald also, one day she said, Why don't you play a Rossetti sonata on your recital, my debut? And I said, Miss McDonald, there's so many scales. I'm terrible at that. She said, oh, no, your technique is great. I said, no, it's not. Please tell me it's so terrible. And she was so supportive. And she would say really things like, one day she was teaching me and she said, you know, I feel like I'm just watching an artist paint and I'm just going to say, put a little color here. And that's the way she was. And she was not controlling, and that's exactly what I got from Pearl also, not control, but I probably made a lot of mistakes along the way, you know, bad fingering choices, but Pearl never gave me a fingering in my life, never. Once she gave me Salzedo's fingering to the Debussy dances, but that was it. Hindemith Sonata she gave me without one marking, and I remember her husband, who was a diamond dealer, he called on the phone one day and he heard me reading it. I was sight reading. I had no mark, not one pedal marking, not one fingering. And he said, tell Nancy she's playing it way too slowly. I said, but I don't know what to do. I was lost. So anyway, I had a collection of teachers, but Marion Bannerman gave me those high thumbs, straight high thumbs. And these days I really anchor onto them because when these fingers start to, you know, get old and you really need your thumb to be there for you. So it's been a long journey. I also had a lot of other people telling me what to do during my life. A lot of conductors who I worked with who were, you know, mentors. Pinka Zukerman took me under his wing and took me to London to the South Bank Festival in 1979. And he would tell me not to do this in Mozart, not to do this in Debussy or in Taillefer concerto. He'd say, don't rush there. Lynn Harrell, some pianists in Aspen, John Perry, a lot of people that were just there. And including, I have to admit, including like early boyfriends, like one was a percussionist and he was so tough on my rhythm. I learned so much at Juilliard because his idea of a date was to go to Juilliard and practice till 11:30. That was dating. Yeah. So I learned a lot about being exact, and I was never precise enough for him, for his taste, but I learned a lot. And then I have a lot of friends who are string players, and I love the string repertoire. So a lot of teachers, but it's everyone helping each other. And that's what's so great about the harp community today, because when we were young, we really didn't have that much interaction. But I will say that when I went to Israel that first time and Pearl took me there and my thumbs were so high, but the rest of my fingers were really bad. They were like this, you know, and Fia Berga, Korchinska, Eileen Malone, Dorothy Remsen, many others were there. And they said, you know, you have a very talented student, but she's got to fix her hand or she's going nowhere. So I went home after that competition, because I was kicked out and I listened to all these great people play. I could name all of them, honestly. But first of all, hearing Martine play recital, Robert Barlow was there. He was Grosjean's, one of Grosjean's favorite students. He's passed away years ago, but I was actually enamored with him, and he played so beautifully. But I came back and I spent the next year of high school. I hardly studied. I just kept my hands in my pockets like this to make my fingers come down. And it was because of all those people that told me, they just felt like they could tell me what to do. The Los Angeles group of harpists, you probably met some of them maybe when you were really little, like Dorothy Remsen, Catherine Gotthoffer, Ann Stockton, Suzanne Balderston, who ran the Salvi. They felt like they were my grandmas or my aunts. And they would, and Eileen Malone too, she would say, Nancy, that was the best you play, or Nancy, that was the worst you ever played, or you were rushing like a bat, you know? And they just felt, one told me I had to wear better shoes. Another one told me I had to pull my hair back. Pearl told me I had to pull my right knee in because it was like a horseback rider, which I was. And they just told me everything. They were like constantly criticizing me. So I always listened. I was just a little girl trying to be good. And so I'm grateful to that for their honesty. They never just sat and said, oh, it's very nice. You know, they let me have it early on.
That's so important. Have this really the mentors who know who wants the best from you and you really trust them. And can you say what gave you Grandjani? Because if you have to change your hands, did you change it just by playing the pieces, or did you change by etudes, by studies, or how did you change that? Because it takes time. And I know that some people who need to change, they change it really like from the beginning. So each finger alone, and it's time taking. So how did you change it?
You know, I think the thing is that you have to look at everyone's hands individually. You do as a teacher too. And you have these extraordinary hands, which I worship. I mean, they're great. You have the greatest hands in the world. But you have to look at everyone's hands individually. And I also know that I have some students who don't play exactly like that. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a great, Emily Hoyle just sent me. Emily Hoyle is, she was at Juilliard years ago. And she just sent me a video of a Piazzolla piece and also some Bach.
And I heard it. It's beautiful. The Piazzolla is fantastic. It's the bassoon player, right?
Yes. And gorgeous. Emily's hands are fantastic, very limber. And she learned on the Klarsach. And her fingers are a little bit, they're not like mine, but I am in awe of everything she does. And so you don't have to play this way. That's my point. But my hands, I have very long thumbs, as you can see. They're like, they're bigger than, you know, than the rest of my hand. And so it helps to have them up. But I'm saying that not everybody has to play that way. But Mr. Grandjani, when I came to him, my thumbs were already high and my fingers were down because that was high school. So he was very happy. He liked my sound. He didn't try to do anything with sound, but he tried to give me more endurance. I remember one lesson when he made me play the Etude de Concert of Godefroy. Mm-hmm. And you know, the one I was playing in the first video, I play his edition, which is very different from the original. His edition is twice harder because he adds a whole left hand. And I remember he took me through a lesson one day, and that's all I played. And he kept saying, more, and play it again, and more. And I was so tired, not hurting, but just tired. And he was trying to make me build phrases and stay loud for a longer period of time. Than in the harp, sometimes we get soft too much, and we don't realize that that in order to sustain our sound, we have to keep enlarging our sound. So when I went to Grandjani, the only big change in my technique that he did, I remember it very well, and I would have done anything for him because I worshiped the ground he walked on, and I had heard his recordings, and I wanted to be able to be like that someday. And I still listen to him, and I can't believe how beautiful it is. But the one big change was that I was playing completely up in the air because I had a lot of, you know, training that way. And Pearl never mentioned anything about my position because I was just relaxed. I must say I was always relaxed, even when I was in the air. And I didn't know, but Mr. Grunge, said, would you just please bring your right hand on a little further, rest this on the board. And it was amazing. I mean, and I remember the same thing with several students who just, Allegra Lilly, who plays in St. Louis, she plays in the air. She's always been my student since she was 17, 18. And she's fantastic. She's always played completely in the air. Alice Giles, fantastic. But for me, because of the way I am, my way I body as I sit, it was just Mr. Groshny could see that it helped me a lot. Mm-hmm. So I immediately had a much better technique. I remember with Catherine Siochi, that was the first thing we did in one of her first lessons. And mm-hmm. and in the first year, and she said, wow, she is phenomenal. You know, they all have phenomenal technique. That's what I learned from Groshny. And Groshny just loved to play the piano, and he take me through lessons. He loved to accompany mm-hmm. the Ravel on the piano. That's couldn't amazing. Play it.
It's so yeah. difficult for the pianist. It's so difficult.
But he was a great pianist and organist, and he was an improviser too. And mm-hmm. and what was amazing to me is that we got along really well, because I was the end of his life. I didn't know it at the time, but it was the end of his life. Mm-hmm. It was the last 3 years of his life, and so lessons were extremely poignant and special in this dark little room, usually at his house apartment. Mm-hmm. And his wife Georgette was in the back room making him breakfast and saying, "Marcel, Marcel, come in." And you had one light bulb in the corner, one little light bulb to light up your lesson, and the harp in the corner, and he would be at the piano. And we got along well because he loved the organ, and he knew that my mother was a church organist. Mm-hmm. And and you know, he liked methods of learning to play the harp. He was trying mm-hmm. to do his own. He had done the Bach book, the etude mm-hmm. book, and he gave me two lifelong exercises, which I promised to show to everybody or to give to them. And I never write it down because I never wrote it in my life. But he loved cycles of fifths, you know, C G D A, and he liked to modulate. And so he took me through two exercises, and one I always show my students. Many of mm-hmm. my students do it now. It starts in all flats, and you go, takes about 3 minutes, 4 minutes, and you get all the way down to sharp, all sharps, and then you go back. I added the going back part, the return, when you go to the dominant seventh. So basically it's a C major chord, mm-hmm. and then a two with a sharp three, D major, then to G major, five, back to to the next key. And so you go to G major, and then you go to D major. And mm-hmm. so I did that for years, but the other etude that he gave me, which he was so proud of, but maybe Kathleen Bride has it, because she and Gloria Agostini and Jane were favorite students of his. But it was based on an organ piece, which I knew when he mm-hmm. told me it, and he laughed out loud that I knew the piece by Charles Maria Vidor, the organist composer of the early part of the century of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. Vidor also wrote a set of variations for harp and orchestra, which nobody plays. And he tried to get me to play it. And I believe I have the music somewhere, so I'll send it to somebody. Vidor was a great musician and a great organist. And he wrote 10 symphonies for the organ, 10 symphonies. It was very unusual to write a symphony for one instrument. Imagine one for the harp. Mm-hmm. And Vidor, in the fifth symphony, mm-hmm. and you've got to listen to them, because the 9 and 10 are weird. They're like, one's called Gothic and one's called Roman, and they're mm-hmm. they're beautiful slow movements. But in the fifth symphony, it for organ solo, the fifth movement of five movements is a toccata. And we harpists, we love toccatas, right? We all do. Toccata means to touch mm-hmm. at your fingers, and we play. We love the loyer, mm-hmm. we love the paradisi, we like anything that moves fast and mm-hmm. and keeps us in shape. But this toccata, my next project I decided for all my present class at Juilliard is we're going to make an arrangement for 8-9 harps and play it together, because wow. it's an F major. It's very easy, actually, but it has left hand chords, which have a rhythm of bum bum ba ba bum bum ba ba bum bum, and the right hand plays it modulates through the cycle of fifths. I was going to play it for you, but I think the sound is so terrible.
It will be fine if you can play it for us.
I'll show you the pattern. So super. It's just, can you see me? No.
Yes, maybe, yeah, we will need to a little bit move the camera, a little bit. Maybe the camera has to be moved to the left, or you can move to the right, indeed. Yes, that would be fantastic. Super.
So it's, I'm just going to play the beginning, so it goes like this. And so the theme would be but anyway, Grangini just took that. Mm-hmm. And he made it into an etude. And uh-huh. the reason he laughed out loud is because it's played at weddings a lot, at the end mm-hmm. of a wedding ceremony, mm-hmm. but it's the fifth movement of the fifth symphony. And, but I played it all my life, and he just laughed because I knew it so well. I said, my mom plays that every day. She was always practicing it on the piano even, but she played on the mm-hmm. organ she used to play for weddings at a church she worked at. Mm-hmm. So I heard it all my life. So that's Charles Maria Vidor. So if it opens up your world to Charles Maria Vidor, you can also mm-hmm. just play a little piece of his called the Toccata. But it's too hard to, probably Jana, you could play it both hands, you know? But it will sound great with multiple harps because it mm. goes through many keys and it's really great music.
Yeah. But yeah. It's great really to have something what you really do entire life. It's great. I can see that it's yeah. really, because yeah. you, when you play, it's, you know, some people when they play, you feel like they will fall out of the strings because they don't have the feeling of really yeah. security on the strings. But when you play, I know that you will never fall. Yeah. That you will
I do. Wait, you I do. I do fall, but I don't want to fall into the ocean, so I'm holding on tight. But I,
it's fantastic. It's so clear. You know, your sound is so clear and so really secured. And as you were talking at the very beginning video, also that you are riding the horses, and that it is somehow connected. That you have the control on the hands and the feet. Maybe we can talk a little bit about it. After we will have another video now, so that we can post a little of the music, because we have so many wonderful. So maybe we can now post the guitar by, again, Alphonse Hasselmans. And it's played by our wonderful guest. She has made the recording yesterday, so it's really very new music. So let's play guitar by Hasselmans. Thank you. So it was wonderful. Bravo again. Fantastic, really. And it's so unknown piece. Actually, you are very right that these pieces are so rarely played at this moment. Mm-hmm. I know that in the time when my mother was studying, it was the repertoire which was usually played, but then it has finished and suddenly it's pity, because that's great that you brought them. How did you choose them?
Well, you know, I love this repertoire. I love all the works of Jacques Ibert and Hasselmans and Zabel. I just play them. I play a lot of them, actually. And guitar, I changed it a lot. If anyone out there does mm-hmm. play it, they know that I'm adding all the trills I added, and a little run at the end. I just made it a little bit different, and I enlarged some of the chords because I felt that it needed a little more character. Like, I used to have a duo with a guitarist. I toured in mostly in Europe with Manuel Barueco, who's a great Cuban guitarist. He teaches at Peabody, and he taught me a lot about the guitar. He used to tell me I was too loud, and he'd say, when you play with a guitarist, you have to talk like you're speaking to a child. And I thought of how many times I yelled at my daughter, but he made me play really softly. And he also was full of color and the different ways they use their fingernails and their fingers and strokes. So that's why I picked that, because I play a lot of guitar music too. I play, for years I played, I recorded and played a lot of Recuerdos de la Alhambra of Tárrega. And I never released it, but I'm going to again. I played a lot of Zabaleta's repertoire. He sent me his transcriptions, and I played Granados. And I love that repertoire. And I love, of course, Mr. Gronchini's De Falla. But the first one, the Nocturne, that's a funny story about it. And so I learned so much from my students, Jana. I'm sure you do too, but I'm older than you much, like two times. And I've taught for a long time, and I was lucky enough to start teaching very early. So I've learned so much from my students. Sometimes I copy them, sometimes I learn what to do, and then sometimes I learn what not to do. But I listen to them, and I really take home a lot of tips and a lot of knowledge from teaching. Mm-hmm. And so anyway, I just pay attention to their concepts and their ideas and their creativity. And this piece came to me. I had never played it. And this was in 1994. We went, four or five, we went to Cardiff to the harp competition. And I brought my student, my wonderful student who might be listening, Alison Nichols. Mm-hmm. She's from England, and she's quarantined out on Long Island on the beach with her three boys and husband during this whole pandemic. Alison wanted to play the Nocturne, and I actually didn't even have the music, and she gave it to me then. And I kept it all those years, and I loved it. And she won first prize in that competition, by the way, and she's living in New York now. But when she was about to play it in the competition, I was sitting next to Gerard DeVos. Did you ever meet Gerard DeVos? He was there's Alison, bravo, Alison. She played it so beautifully in my house, and I've always been afraid to play it for her, but I'm going to go out to her house and play it for her now that I know it. But I was sitting next to Gerard DeVos, who was a judge, along with Jean-Michel Damas. Mm-hmm. And some other English harp people. I guess Ossian was there too. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure. Ossian Ellis, yeah. And Damas and Gerard DeVos. And Gerard was very funny, and he spoke English very well, but he said to me in the middle of it, she was about to play this piece, and he pointed to it and he said, "Pourquoi le Nocturne?" You know? And I went, "Pourquoi?" He said, "C'est facile. It's easy." And I said, "You wait." Mm-hmm. And she played it so beautifully. It really, she played Hindemith and Foray and everything else, but this took the house down. And I always remember that, Allison. And then I've heard other people play it recently. I just loved it so much. Because again, it's like Chopin. You know, a lot of people are playing beautiful preludes, nocturnes of Chopin. Mm-hmm. But this is ours. It's original. And that's why I played that. The other two that you're going to hear, I think, if we have time, are the Petite Valse. I forgot to write Petite. It's Petite Valse. Mm-hmm. And that one I had never heard. I played it. And I'm playing all of his works, actually. And then Jacques Ibert. I played Scherzo of Ibert was one of the very first difficult harp pieces I ever played when I was a kid. And I don't know how I did it. I don't know how I could, because it's hard. So that's there too. But that I just think is a lot of fun. And I love the flute concerto of Ibert and Escal, mm-hmm. the orchestra. I've played that in orchestra many times. So I just think these composers and their works, the easier harp works. There was a piece, Zabel La Source. I love the Zabel La Source. Mm-hmm. My father loved it. And we heard it played in Marian Bannerman's harp ensemble when I was a kid. I was just learning to play the harp. I had to stand up to play the harp. I was so small. And there was a girl named Susan Page, and she was my father's idol, and she became my idol. She studied mm-hmm. with Groncheny. And then she's somewhere in the world. I've never been able to contact her. I think she's up in Boston. I don't know. I'd love to tell her what she meant to me, because she played this piece, La Source, so beautifully. And the harp ensemble played it. When it came to the solo, she played it. So I, after I'd played Rodrigo Concerto and Ginastera many times, I went back and I learned the Zabel La Source, actually, mm-hmm. sadly for my father's funeral, but I was determined to play it well for him as well as mm-hmm. Susan Page played it. And it's one of my favorite pieces. I just gave it to my little student who's here today, Eunice Park, and her brother Wesley, a wonderful harpist. And I gave it to her recently. She said, this is hard, and but it's really beautiful music, and mm-hmm. we have, maybe the rest of the world doesn't know our harp beloved old-fashioned harp repertoire, mm-hmm. but years ago, a famous harpist said to me, "Why do you want to be a soloist? You'll just have to play the four impromptu a lot." Mm-hmm. And I said, "Great, I love it," and I think that would be my most important thing that I tell my students, that don't get in this if you don't love this instrument, because mm-hmm. we can play contemporary music. Like I'm going to play some for you mm-hmm. today. And we can have a great new voice, and we can partake in orchestra. And that's thrilling. I love playing in the Philharmonic. I feel like I'm part of a big team, and mm-hmm. they make me sound good, they sound so great. But we have to remember our past, and we have to remember mm-hmm. what repertoire was there when Groncheny and Regnier were learning, and it's mm-hmm. so beautiful. And so I feel like I'm a little bit like a museum. It's mm-hmm. our primitive harp too, our earlier music but this French and German music that was written years ago. I gave one of my students, I don't think she's here today, but she's in Germany, in Amsterdam now, Miriam Roof, who you heard mm-hmm. in the USA competition. She's at Juilliard now this year. And mm-hmm. she, I gave her the works of Posse. I gave her two waltzes. And, mm-hmm. and she played one for me the other day. I used to play them a lot. And I remember playing them in Paris in 1990. And Nicolas Tullier was there, and June Hahn, and Beatrice Gehrman maybe. And they were all, and I was playing these Posse works, and I played the Carnival of Venice, which everyone knew. But I picked these waltzes, which nobody knew. When Miriam played it the other day for us, it was amazing. It's just repertoire that we couldn't get it for a long time. But it's a lot of fun mm-hmm. to play, and it's challenging because the person who wrote it knows mm-hmm. how difficult it is to play the harp, and how to make it sound good. And that's the beauty of Hasselmann's. He knows how to make a sound.
Indeed, and beautiful. He knew how to write for the harp, and he was the harpist. It's so strange that actually the violinists, they have the Paganini, they have the Wieniawski, they have all this repertoire, and it's also maybe not as a fantastic composition, but it is already written by the composer violinist or the virtuoso. Right. We have the same, but somehow mm-hmm. it's said that the harp pieces are not so good, so that they should not be put into the program too much. But I don't feel that it's the right thing. We should do that, because that's where the harp can really sound the most wonderfully, because the people knew how to write for the instrument.
Yeah, I agree. I wish we could all just... our repertoire is not as great as the repertoire pianists have to play. So we really have to try to know it all and at least play it. We don't have to memorize it all the time, but at least if we learn these early pieces and really take them seriously, because these composers were great melodists. They knew how to write melodies, and they knew, I mean, Fauré, of course, was the master of harmony, but they had a harmonic sense that is so important in our development. So
absolutely, it's so clever what you are saying, and really so wise, and I'm sure
Thank
that
you.
Everybody also really totally agree. And we have so many wonderful messages here, so I would like to show just some of them, because from Marisa Robles, it's lovely again. Thank you very much, Marisa. So you can of course read it. So I think that there is the one question: if you do remember your recital in Cardiff in the World Harp Festival.
Marisa Robles, hello. She's the queen of the harp. And I remember Marisa said to me once in New York, she said, you know, I might not stay in touch with a lot of harpists, but I like you, and I'm gonna stay in touch with you. And she came and gave a class for my students. Nicolas Toulier was there at the time. I remember, because he played chords for her. And Nicolas is the harpist in the Radio France now. And Marisa sat down at the harp, and she just played a few chords. And she said, you know, I'm practicing to do whatever I can't do. She said, if I can't do it, then I'll make an etude out of it. And she sat down at the harp, my harp, and she sounded amazing. It was just the most beautiful sound. And then later she came to New York, and she played a recital. And she was playing Fauré impromptu. And she called me the day before. She said, Nancy, I need your music. I need your music. I don't have any music with me. And so I dropped it off at her hotel. And then she played a fantastic, she sent it back to me that night. She said, I don't have time to look at the music. God will help me. And she was like the essence of a natural musician, a natural harpist, you know, someone who's just going to play from their heart and not worry about the little buzzes and the things, which she didn't have any. But anyway, love to Marisa, and I learned a lot from her.
She's really a fantastic inspiration for everybody, and it's true, she's an artist as you are, and that I feel sometimes that in this generation the people are too much controlling, and sometimes there it's losing the spirit of nature, and so to really share the music, because it's everything going too much to the perfections. And sometimes when you do too much perfections, you cannot open yourself to be really like a musician who can give everything. And just if you have some buzzings, whatever, you know, it's the music is more important. Exactly.
You know, that's such a good point. And I have said this to my students recently, and they might not like that I'm repeating it, but I really mean it. I said to them one day that I had played something at home, and it was so good that day. It was so good. Maybe it was like one of the transcriptions I've recently done that you might even hear today. And I said, you know, and they looked at me like, wow, she's full of confidence. I said, no, you know, I'm not really. I'm the biggest critic of my own work. But I said, if you can't come in here and tell me that you love your playing, there's something wrong. You have to love your playing. Every time I sit down at the harp, even if I buzz, I love to hear. It's not me. It's just the fact that I have this training and I love music. But you have to love what you're doing, because if you're going to criticize yourself about every single note, every single buzz, every single wrong pedal, you're not loving your own product. And that's what we're in this for, performance. And you have to. You can't come off and say that was terrible. You know, that was terrible. You have to appreciate what you're doing, and I think most of the older generation does. We know how hard it is, but the younger generation, you honestly, you have to rise to a certain level of perfection. I was never a perfect harpist, you know, so I don't have that pressure. I was never perfect, but I was also very good at letting it go and not beating myself over the head when I didn't do something so well. But I think they need to love their instrument and the repertoire and their own playing, and everybody else's too, because we couldn't listen to Jana Boušková on our telephone when we were young. And now you can listen to anyone, and it's amazing. So to use that as an inspiration rather than a competition, just say, oh, wow, that's how she does that. I know when she, something you did the other day, I watched, it was something trill. I mean, trilling, you know, everyone knows your trills are from God. And something you did in some piece, I don't even remember now. And I was breathless. And I thought, God, I have to go practice. I better go practice because I want to be her that day. You know, it's true. They have this gift of being able to be everything so immediate. We didn't have that. We had to work on our own, and I had never heard anyone else. I had never heard any young person play many of the pieces I played when I did. So now my students have each other to hear.
Yeah, but on the other hand, you are the original, and you were the inspiration later on for everybody, because you were the original and you were not copying anybody, you know, so that you work on yourself. And I think that it has been also a big treasure for that generation, that there were all the people were different and all the people were unique. So that's something what is, I think from that period of time, it's very fantastic, because at this time, I think that, as you said, everybody has this privilege to listen to everybody. Everybody has the chance to copy everybody, but it's a little bit missing the original thing. So that's, I think that you are really an example of amazing original, which is so inspiring for everyone. Mm-hmm. And I would like again to show some of the videos, and maybe we can now show the contemporary piece which you were talking about. You send me a piece, just tell us a little bit, because it has been recently written for you.
Okay, so you're talking about a piece written by a young composer, a friend of my daughter's, William Healy. Mm-hmm. William was born in 1990, and he was in our town, and he was always over playing our piano. He played a lot of music with my daughter on the cello, and he also was improvising. And they were outside one day, and I was playing. Practicing Danse Lutin, and he came in and he sat down at the piano and he played, you know, he played it, and I never heard it before, and I was so angry at him because he was only 17 years old, and I said, okay, you're gonna have to be a composer too. And so he became a composer. He's a wonderful composer. He's I'm gonna forget everything he's done. He was born in 1990. He's won 2 ASCAP awards, which are very prestigious publishing company awards. He won the Charles Ives Scholarship, and he studied with John Corigliano, famous American composer. Mm-hmm. He has a group called Shout House that my daughter was one of the original members in. It's a hip hop / everything, world music, classical music, everything, but it's hip hop based. And Will is maybe listening, I don't know. But anyway, Will, I call him my personal composer and arranger. He's arranged a folk song suite for me, which will be published soon as we come out of this mess. It was written for me. It started with, I don't have them today. I wish I did, but they're not finished recording yet. Scarborough Fair. For my 60th birthday, I said, I want an arrangement of Scarborough Fair, which was a famous English tune and also done by, American rock group. And, Simon and Garfunkel. And so he gave me a beautiful trio arrangement for flute and cello. And then he added 3 others. There's Will. Hey, Will. And he wrote the Water is Wide, which is an old folk song. It's a folk song suite. There's 4 movements for first trio with viola or for cello. And they are gorgeous. So, but he, anyway, so together we took the challenge of entering. He entered. I was just his accomplice. Entered the world, the USA International Harp Composition Contest, right? Mm-hmm. The funny part of it is it was when Catherine Siochi's brother won, piece won, mm-hmm. and she's my student. We submitted our piece. Will wrote this fantastic work, hard, and I recorded it for him. And it was entitled, it is sort of jazzy, but sort of modern. And he just has this improvisational talent that he put to test on the harp. And he also likes extremities. He likes the very top of the harp and the very low of the harp. And that's the hardest thing, as we all know, is to play like this, right? Not like playing it's not like playing au matin. It's like this. And so a lot of this piece, you can't see it today, but we don't have a video because that was before people started videoing. Mm-hmm. But anyway, often poetry inspires music, like Fauré with Paul Verlaine, or in Châtelain Sautour of Fauré. But in this case, after Will wrote Orbit, and we were just about to record it, or we just had recorded it, he was trying to think of a title for it, and we were sitting around talking, and somehow we came up with, I suggested, I guess he's called it Orbit, and I was thinking of things that were connected to orbit, and I thought of my favorite poet, one of my favorite poets, certainly, was a Czech poet, Rilke, Rainer Maria Rilke, mm-hmm. and for years has been my poet, with Emily Dickinson and then some modern poets, mm-hmm. and so Rilke wrote a poem called, he says, I live my life in growing orbits, which move out over the things of the world. Perhaps I can never achieve the last, but that will be my attempt. I don't know if I am a falcon or a storm or if I'm a great song. And that became the, after the fact, attached to his orbit. So it's a challenging piece, and we submitted it. And we didn't get any attention. And it made me think of all the pieces that have been submitted that are really, truly great, as well as the ones that win, like Catherine's, Jeremiah Siochi's work, mm-hmm. and all the other works. But this was so beautiful. I really was hoping that people would play it. And it hasn't been published yet. Marion Raveau, mm-hmm. who's playing in Germany now, she was from my class, also French, wonderful French harpist. Hi, Marion, she's not mm-hmm. here today. But she played it at Juilliard for a composer's forum. Mm-hmm. But other than that, I don't think it's been performed. So this is really the first time it would be heard, Orbit.
Oh, wow. We have a premiere here. And I have mm-hmm. Allowed myself to make a video out of it because I had only the audio. So I edit some photos. We will have photos, not really video, but we will have with the beautiful music. So now enjoy the Orbit by
William Healy.
Mm-hmm. William Healy, right. That's it. That's the piece, right? Is it finishing?
No, it's much longer than that.
It's I'm so sorry because I thought that I made the complete one. Oh, I'm so sorry.
Because maybe
it was cut again and the computer did not edit the whole thing. So I'm so sorry, but I promise I will do it complete and I will maybe put it on the Harp channel. So sorry, okay, my mistake, without knowing that it will be like that.
So that it's very complicated, and it would be great to post it, because I think that someone, the harpist, would love to play it. It's very beautiful as it develops. It's a great composition. Thanks.
Well, great. I'm so bravo. Sorry. Yeah, I will certainly make it, because I was sure that I did the whole complete thing. So that has somehow been cut by the program. So I'm very sorry for that. But it's really beautiful. So thank you very much for this composition. And I really hope that it will be possible to be played.
It will be published soon.
Yeah, perfect. Mm-hmm. Is it going to be published by which company? Do you know where?
I don't know. Well, I'll talk to Will about that. Yeah, we're working on the folk songs also, because the folk songs is something that everyone has a trio, and they're really beautiful, and they're very accessible, mm-hmm. Because they're such famous melodies, and Orbit is much more elusive and challenging. But I really think it taught me a lot of things I didn't know how to do on the harp, and you hear later in the piece a lot of the techniques. It was so hard.
I'm deeply sorry, because I was absolutely sure that it's complete. So I'm so sorry for that. And it has been, I'm so really sad about it. But Nancy, just tell me, because after you finish your studies, and it was really, as you said, you were studying with Lily Luskin, you were studying with Marcel Granjani, you were having also other teachers. But then after your studies, did you get the position as the principal harpist in New York right away? Or how was your way? Mm-hmm. Get to this position?
But wasn't for a very, very long time, because I really didn't want to. I played in the Orpheus Ensemble, which is a conductorless mm-hmm. chamber orchestra, for many, many years. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I was around at the inception of the orchestra, in the very, very beginning when it started. But I remember that there was one conductor, Romanian, Sergiu Comisiona, and he asked me to come down and audition. He said, "Are you interested in auditioning for the Baltimore Symphony?" And and his manager called me, because I knew him from Aspen. And I said, "You know, please tell Maestro Comisiona." I can't believe I said it, but I said, "Please tell him if I were ever to or join an orchestra, I would want it to be under his baton. But right now in my life, I want to go fly and do my thing." So I never really, I played an orchestra my whole life. I started playing in a professional orchestra when I was 15 in the Hudson Valley. In fact, in the pictures that I sent you, there are pictures of a conductor, Claude Monteux. Claude mm-hmm. Monteux was the son of Pierre Monteux, the man who premiered The Rite of Spring. And Claude mm-hmm. was a flute.
I have no idea when is it. So we will go through the photos later.
He's a very handsome gentleman. He's French. He played the flute. And he's looking over my shoulder while I'm playing. And he mm-hmm. taught, he took me through my first Nutcracker Suite, my first Berlioz Symphony Fantastique, my first Debussy Dances, my Mozart, my Handel. He let me play, and he made me play with the orchestra when I was very young. So, you'll see it in the pictures. But I'm sorry, you were saying.
This is not him, probably.
No, that was an early collaboration in Aspen with the friend who taught me all about percussion, Barry Ducasse. we were playing George Crumb. That was a famous movie star. He's a television sitcom. He was in my church, and my mother asked me. My father and my mother asked me to play the Fourier Requiem with him. That's how I was 12. And so I learned the Fourier Requiem felt sort of a little bit like, I could accomplish that. And he was on television in a very famous soap opera called Days of Our Lives. Everybody in America watched Days of Our Lives, Bill Hayes. And so I had this picture with him, and he's still alive somewhere in the world, but he was such a famous, mm-hmm. like a soap opera star, but he sang beautifully too. So that was my first Fourier Requiem, which is also something very dear to my heart.
Fantastic. Love the piece. And do you know what was your first harp ever, which you had?
I think they rented a very old, an old 15, a very small single, a double action. A smaller harp. My older sister was playing on a 22, mm-hmm. and I probably took my first lessons, but then they got me that. But then that was a rental, and then they bought, when I was 12, my mm-hmm. parents bought me a Princess Louise. It was called the Style 30, mm-hmm. a Black 30, and I had that until it broke, and it broke just before it broke in 1972, just before the Israel competition, and someone bought it. I had it rebuilt, and it came back, and it never sounded as good as it was, mm-hmm. and I wasn't happy anymore, and so I ordered a salve. Victor Salve sent me a beautiful Minerva, and that Minerva that I play. There's Victor, and Victor was like an uncle or father. And Nicoletta, his daughter, is a very good friend of mine. And so I saw a lot of Victor in his later life up at her home nearby. But Victor sent me a Minerva. And I remember it only cost $5,000 in those days. And it was a good price anyway. And that harp, that Minerva, was a blonde Minerva. It had, I think, five or six concert debuts. Okay, I played it in Carnegie Recital Hall, which is now called, I don't know what it's called now, Carnegie Recital Hall, that smaller hall, beautiful hall next to Weill Concert Hall. I gave my debut there. And then Isabel Moretti came to town and she wanted to play a salve for her debut at Tully Hall. It was outstanding. She had this beautiful dress on with a shawl. I'll never forget it. And she made my harp sound like magic. That was its next debut. Then Xavier de Messer came and he gave a debut. He played my salve. Miss McDonald and I were there, and we had dinner with him before, and he ate a steak, a whole steak, a half an hour before. And then he went and played this great, I remember he played the Bartok Romanian dances so fantastically. And he had a complete dinner in his stomach. And Miss McDonald, I think he had some wine too. We couldn't believe it. But that was on the same Minerva. And then Gwyneth Wenty came and gave her debut at the 92nd Street Y. She actually played on it a few times, I think. She also played the Crown of Ariadne on it. And so this Minerva had a big, big history. And I played it for a long time, but it was very heavy for me to carry. And then I was in Israel, and I heard Katrine Yates, my colleague and wonderful harpist, in the competition. She was playing a Horngacher. And I loved that. I like I have big hands and I like the spacing. Yeah. I love the sound of the instrument, but I like the spacing. And right now I've got in back of me, my Horngacher. This one's the Philharmonic. And then I've got the old studio harp from Julia. It was an old 23, which is like playing, it's like playing a magical genie. You know, I got like some kind of magical spirit because it's very old. It was Mr. Grosjean's studio harp and no one was playing it. So I brought it home just to see. It needs to be re-riveted and reworked. Mm-hmm. It's in not great shape, but when you play it, it's like playing whipped cream. You know, it's amazing. Strings are much closer together. So when I came back to the Horngacher last week, because it had been in the hall all boxed up during COVID-19, I said, wow, I never realized it's hard for me to go between the two, but I do it. But you have to really, you have to work a whole lot harder on the Horngacher. Mm-hmm. But my first was a style 30, my very first harp. I don't know where someone has it. Someone bought it years ago. But I also, you know, we all have to go play many different harps. But I did travel with my own harp most of my career. Because you asked me about the orchestra, and so I only played solo until I joined the Philharmonic in 1999, 20 years ago, and I'm 65. 66 next Saturday. And I was 44 years old when I joined the Philharmonic. However, I played with them when I was a student. I played second harp a lot as a substitute. So, but because I knew the repertoire, I'd been in Aspen Festival my whole life and with this Claude Monteux conducting the Hudson Valley Philharmonic. So I learned my repertoire. I did my homework. I was prepared for whatever, however I could make a living. I had to make a living. That was the truth. I was pretty much on my own, you know, and financially and I did sessions with, you know, the click tracks and movies and I played, you know, receptions. I played weddings. I did anything like everyone does today, you know, but I did not want to join an orchestra, and I did only recitals. I was lucky to have Angel EMI Records in back of me, for a long time, and a very good management, Columbia mm-hmm. Artists Management, and I had a duo with Ransom Wilson, the flutist. I had this duo with Manuel Barueco, and I had the Orpheus Ensemble, and we recorded the Mozart Concerto for Deutsche Grammophon. So it was just mm-hmm. like, you know what, Jana? If I had grown up in this environment with all these fantastic people, starting with you, when I was young, I might have given up. But it's like being in the right time, at the right place at the right time, when I could see a little space. And the world was different. There were more solo recitals to be mm-hmm. had. And so I got to hand it to everyone today for keeping at it, because it's hard. It's hard out there. And I was very lucky. I remember listening to Zabaleta play that Prokofiev Prelude on a recording mm-hmm. one day. I was quite young. I was about 16. I was playing in my foyer of my house, and the sound was fantastic. And I was playing along with him, and I said, I think I can do this. I think that I want to do this because I love the sound of the harp alone. So then when I did join the Philharmonic, I was already 44 years old. Mm-hmm. And I did play for them once before. They asked me to audition the time before, but I didn't get it. And I really couldn't have imagined, because my whole career was yet to happen. Mm-hmm. I was already recording, and but I knew I could do it if I wanted to, but it wasn't the kind of thing in the 70s that people were looking for. The students in general were just, we were looking to play better. We were not mm-hmm. looking for a job. Most of us, and I'm talking about not just harpists, but mm-hmm. we weren't concerned about an income, because you didn't need that much, you know, and you didn't need that much. Today's world is mm-hmm. entirely different. I don't know. I'd be an entirely different person today, and my heart goes out to the harpists who are working so hard, and mm-hmm. And they're doing so well, you know, and getting jobs and creating groups mm-hmm. and creating chats and harp mm-hmm. hangouts that Grace Browning just started. I just got an email from her yesterday about a harp hangout. It's fantastic, mm-hmm. And I'm forgetting all my names because I'm getting old.
It's fantastic.
The harp schools, all the things. Mm-hmm. We didn't have master classes when I was a kid. There were mm-hmm. no master classes. I went to Jean-Pierre Rampal's for flute and played with a flutist there. And I thought, why do we not have public master classes? Why can we have mm-hmm. Susan McDonald come or Judy Lohman? Again, mm-hmm. you know, I had never heard Judy Lohman play when I was a student. Mm-hmm. And now it's different. They can play for literally anyone. They can call you up and do this and play for you. It's mm-hmm. so unimaginable to any of us, you know.
Absolutely. And how old have you been when you were participating and won the competition in Israel? How old have you been?
I was 19.
19. So the your life has opened, your professional life. Do you think that when you won, it has helped also for your career at that moment?
You know, when I came back from Israel, Robert Barlow, who was Mr. Grangey's, one of his favorite students, he mm-hmm. had not won, but he was my idol. And mm-hmm. he said to me, he was sort of in a harp room at Juilliard, he said, so what's it done for you? Or what's it going to do for you? And I was sort of embarrassed almost, because I knew he was so good. You know, he was so wonderful, and many other people too. But I got to say that my mom was particularly not a backstage mother. So I always tell the story of coming back from Israel and taking the taxi back from the airport. And I walked in the front door, and my mom said, what do you want for dinner? You know, it was like not a really big deal in my house. And you didn't really talk about things like that. I mean, it was a big deal, but it was not so. But prizes, recordings, everything makes the people that can't judge you believe you, you know, because you know, we know if we're playing well or bad, but the managements and the concert world is a whole different assessment. And mm-hmm. they, you can walk in and say, I play really well and I deserve a career, but they need to feel like they can market you and they can mm-hmm. do something. So what it did was it validated what I was doing for myself. I didn't believe in myself at that point. The first year after Israel was the hardest time of my life. And I would bet that many prize winners of Israel feel the same thing, or USA. You feel like, wow, I learned that program and I got a prize. But that doesn't mean, you know, as Marielle Nordman said once to me, to the students, she said, we were judging a competition. She said, as soon as you think you're the best, you're not. You know? And, you know, so you have this one prize, but it was a little stamp. It was like a little stamp on my stationery that I could say, you know, someone liked me. it's an endorsement. It's like a label. And then Angel Records was what really helped me the most, recording. And playing a lot of, I played a lot of concerts in a lot of small places. I played all over the United States, and then my guitar and harp duo played many places in mostly Germany. Mm-hmm. That's before any of you were born. my daughter was one, maybe. Mm-hmm.
And did you carry her with you all the time?
I was a single mom from the beginning. Mm-hmm. It was just me and my daughter. Her dad's great. He lives in Washington. But it was just she and me alone. And and that's Claire. And there's my horn gawker. So
wonderful.
Yeah, she was with me all the time. She was backstage in dressing rooms. I nursed her until she was three. So because it was easier in Germany, I was traveling a lot in Europe then. I remember I took her on a tour to Finland, and we went to Budapest, and she got a fever, and I was having to play the Debussy dances that night, and then I would have to have babysitters I've never seen in my life. I don't recommend it to any of the young harpists who are having children now. Take care of your child and use the time to practice, but don't do what I did. It was crazy, but I traveled with her until she was five. When she was five, I played with the New York Philharmonic on a tour to China. Mm-hmm. I wasn't in the orchestra yet. And so I had all those early years still just playing solo. And she was five and I took her to China, and she wrote a report about walking on the Great Walls and how the Great Wall of China now brought people together instead of separating them. And she was in she was in my arm. She was five. She was a big girl, but she loved going to all the concerts. And consequently, I didn't want to always have babysitters because I felt really guilty. So I would buy very, very expensive third row seats for the concerts. And they cost me a lot, you know, $300 a ticket. And she would sit there and she'd be sitting in concerts all over the world. And she'd have her little book. And then the clapping at the end. And she'd still be reading her book. But I could see her during the whole concert. So it was a little more expensive than babysitting, but it was that one night I did leave her alone in Taipei, I think. And one of my students sent two young Chinese students to babysit for her, and they were lovely, but they didn't speak any English. So she thought it was magnificent to have two kids with her all evening. And we played the concert. We were with, I think Lauren Mazel conducting, and I came back and I said, how was it? I paid them and they went home. And I said, how was it? She said, oh, it was great. By this time she's six. She said, it was great. I said, well, did you eat anything? She said, oh yes. I took them to the buffet, and the buffet at the fancy restaurant was like $75 a piece. Right. And I said, you took them to the buffet? She said, yeah, you said to get something to eat. So it's a fancy buffet. So I said, well, what did you all eat? She said, French fries. And oh God, that was the most expensive evening of my life. But at least I knew she was safe because she was with harp. They were harpists and they were so cute. And I'm sure they loved the buffet.
Oh, that is so sweet. But I think that to have really the child with you all the time, it's, of course, it's not easy, but it's possible. And I think that as you were breastfeeding, I have also breastfeeded a second one with 2 years. And also I was traveling with him everywhere. So I know how it is. But I remember these times so much. And I'm so happy that I went through.
Yeah. Oh, great. It's a good mama you are. Yeah.
I think that we know how important it is also for our children, and it's really something very special and not repeatable. We cannot repeat it anymore, yeah, with the children. So that's really something so special. And so, and the, I think that the children also appreciate it very much that they can be with us. So it's, and as we were talking about you and in the orchestra, I would like to show now a really amazing video which you showed, she sent to me, and it's with the singer Mrs. Battle. Yeah, is that like that?
That's before I was in the Philharmonic. I was not in the Philharmonic yet, and that was with some members of the Philharmonic and James Levine conducting, and the Spirituals in concert. And literally the day before, 2 days before, I met with them, with Hubert Laws, the great jazz flute player, and Levine, and they had this music, and there really wasn't much music except chord changes. And it was for this spirit, two spirituals, Over My Head, There Is Music in the Air, There Is Music in the Air, There Must Be a God Somewhere, and Little David, Play on Your Harp. And she said, and so Kathy sang, and I had played a lot with Kathy. She taught me more than anybody, you know, when to not come in early, when not to step on a vowel or a consonant that she was singing. Mm-hmm. She taught me about discipline. And we recorded a day before I gave birth. I was in the recording studio with her. But she, so in this rehearsal, and it was 2 days before that live broadcast, which you will see, James Levine is standing there like, okay, play your piece for me. And there's no music for me. There's no music. She says, okay, and now you play chords and then you accompany him. And then we start Little David, Play on Your Harp. And she said, and at this, when I sing the verse, Little David, play.
Oh, I have anything. The good one. That's amazing.
I've got 1 day, 24 hours to make something up. And I thought, oh, with all my, I'm not a jazz musician. I'm not an improviser, but I've learned my chords. And I went home and I said, okay, I have to play this and I have to make it sound like a little harp that David would play. And it has to be showy because she's going to go like this, and she's a great star. And this is live from Lincoln Center, and James Levine is standing there. And he's just like this. He's not conducting it. So I went home and I said, okay, think. So I listened to the song, Little David, Play on Your Harp, you know? And I said, oh, I hear music. I hear pentatonic. And I hear the same chord that Salzedo heard in Scintillation. I heard a pentatonic glissando. And I knew I could get from one chord to another chord, to the five chord, moving my feet very fast. And I said, I made it in my head. So anyway, we did it the next day live, and this is it. And it's especially with what's going on in America now, with Black Lives Matter, this was the height of celebration of spirituals and the history of Black culture in America, because it was a whole program of the whole concert's on video, and there's a lot of harp in it. But I learned my spirituals that night. I learned all of them, because they sang them. Jesse Norman, the late Jesse Norman, sang also. And but this was really exciting to be a part of, and I'll never forget it. So it's a nice time to be listening to something of Kathleen Battle, and she was truly magnificent. And I was extremely lucky to be able to work with her. We played at least 15 recitals together. Yeah, and we played at the White House together. We played it for the justices. We played on television, live television at 5 o'clock in the morning on Christmas Day. We did a lot of things. Anyway, I learned a lot from her because she was so demanding, but she was always gracious to me, and we had a really lovely relationship. And anyway, I hope you like it. I this is my favorite.
And I must say, it is amazing. If you now I know even the story, I can't believe it, because it is fantastic harp. It's really fantastic. It's a great part. It's a fantastically played. You will just enjoy it. I was impressed. I had to listen to it many times. And I'm just sorry, it's again cut to five parts. So you will see it. But it's fantastic. Enjoy it.
Played on
Bravo. It's really amazing. And I need to really share with you all these fantastic comments, because it's absolutely breathtaking, as it's also written by some people, because it's really just fantastic. How did you play? How the whole atmosphere, everything. It's gorgeous. Yes. Did you play it many times afterwards, or?
We played different, she kept changing things. We played it without Hubert. We played it once more with Hubert on the flute, but then we did it alone. So we did it once in Philadelphia with the Philadelphia Orchestra and the Israel Phil hi, Marisa. For the Israel Phil, their birthday of Israel. And Zubin was conducting, but we did this alone, just Kathleen and I. And we were in the middle of an ice hockey stadium. And so it was a little bit different because I had to play the whole flute stuff too. And then we played it many, many times. Yeah, in different versions of it. And I think Kathleen did it with some other harpists, but not exactly my version, because we never really published it or anything. It was just the solo. I don't know if I sent it to one person once, the music. You can see on the music stand, there's no real music. It's just taped chord changes and a few things. But I tell you, that woman could sing, and she still makes me breathless to hear her ability to sing. And she was teaching school when she started to sing opera. She was just in a regular job, and since then she was a regular lady, and someone discovered her voice, and she just went like crazy with her career at the Met. And then the last concert I ever sang with her was just spirituals in Carnegie Hall, just with a pianist and harp, and that was about 8 years ago. Yeah, she's still singing, but I treasure all the rehearsals I treasure with her, because she was, if you couldn't take the demands that she put upon you. I mean, she would be in the middle. We'd be in the middle of a recording session. We did one of Japanese melodies, and then she would say, "Send me this music to someone, her manager," and it would arrive in the computer, and you'd have to play it, and you have to arrange it or something, or different key. Can you do it in another key? And sometimes I'd be so stressed, because I never knew when she would call me and want me to fly somewhere to play, to play a concert or somewhere. It just really was always at the last minute when she suddenly get something. And we did a lot of exciting things. The most exciting was at the White House for the Pope, and we were sitting together, and George Bush was there. We rehearsed all day at the White House, and then the next day was the big ceremony on the White House, the back lawn of the White House. And I met President Bush, and regardless of your political direction, he was very, very nice and kind and so receptive to us, and his wife as well. And then we were out on the lawn sitting together, Kathleen and I, and in chairs, and there was Bush, and he looked at us and he winked like that. And then we were about to sing, and millions of people. And Kathleen grabbed my hand, and she clutched my hand tight, and she said, "Nancy, this is really big." This is really big. And so it was about 90 degrees out. And it was good to know that Kathleen Battle could get nervous too. You know, yeah. But I did French songs with her, German songs, folk songs, lullabies. We did a lot of lullabies, Japanese sakura. There's a beautiful recording. I don't know. I wasn't good at collecting everything, you know, but there's a beautiful recording of sakura, the cherry blossom song, that we did together. And always they were just arrangements, you know. I just learned to sit at the edge of my chair for her, and I would do anything for her. But I must say it was filled with some anxiety of how to think on your feet and to understand what she wanted, when you had to leave out certain chords because it was too thick for her voice, or whether in the Lord's Prayer, I remember she added measures and beats because she needed to take breaths. So I learned about one thing we don't do on the harp so much is breathe. Mm-hmm. So I learned about breathing, you know, and how music isn't really shouldn't be like metronomic all the time, that we should be human and we should be breathing. Even if we don't have to breathe to play our instrument, we need to breathe.
I think that the singers really gives us the imagination better than anything else. So that if we can cooperate with the singers, it's always the big lesson and really big inspiration. Yeah. And you said that you have recordings, also the CDs together.
Somewhere. So, they're in my boxes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Is it possible to get it still for the people who would like to buy it? Is it possible to order it still?
I don't know. This is the whole recording world changed, you know, in the 80s. It just, everything changed. So maybe things are on, Brandy, thank you. And maybe they're available online, but most of my arrangements I have, you know, just in a file that says Kathleen Battle. You know, Jana, you're much younger than me. I'm, you know, in a certain stage in my career. And so I'm looking forward to having time to getting all this together. Years ago, someone asked me to, Fisher asked me to, the publishing company, to publish my transcriptions. And I said, you know, I'm raising a child. And he said, but you must have them all done. I said, well, but everything's a mess and I'll do it someday. And that day is coming. It's really coming soon. I think maybe 4 years, and I'll have time to sit and make sure that my little things that I did that I like are available. But I also know that one of the ways in which I teach is to try to make everyone self-sufficient and to do their own. And as soon as I always say, you know, I don't trust anyone's fingering starting with my own, you know, that I want people to do their own Scarlattis. That's why I never published any of my Scarlatti sonatas, because I want them to discover it like I did, and to trial by trial and error, learn what fingerings work and what, and to learn about articulation, and not just to play 4-3-2-1, 3-2-1-2, 1-2-1-2, 3-2-1, you know, not to just do it that way, but just to be more about the music and the phrasing and to figure it out themselves. So, but having said that, someday I will do my homework and think, and when I finally learn how to play the harp well, write it down.
No, you should certainly put it down, because it's your child, music child. Yeah, also, yeah. So that should be also brought to the life, because it's fantastic what you have everything done. And also, as we have some more videos, if you don't mind, we will just now put some of the music of your Hasselmanns again from your recital. And I would like to play the Petit Waltz, as you said that it calls, and it has been, for those who came later, it is recital which Nancy was so kind to do for us yesterday. So it is very recent video. So enjoy Waltz, Petit Waltz by Hasselmanns. Thank you. again. Bravo, bravo. And it's such a beautiful piece as well. It's really lovely. It's so lovely. Did you play it now recently? Did you learn it now, or this piece that you played before already?
No. I learned it recently. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I love it. I'm learning all of Hasselmann's, all of his works, and all of Ebert's short works too. I'm just trying to learn everything that I should have learned when I was young and I didn't. Because when you're a harpist, you learn a few little things, and then you have to play the Ceremony of Carols of Benjamin Britten. You take big jumps too fast. And in America especially, I found that there wasn't the pedagogy early on that you get in Paris or probably in Prague too. I think now there's a better way of teaching. We didn't have Suzuki. We didn't have anything like that. Mm-hmm. So we jumped too far too soon. So I was clever, but I really needed to. I wish I had played more of this music when I was young. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Do you remember what repertoire did you have for the Israel when you won? Do you remember what was there?
Chantal and I were talking. Chantal Mathieu, who was one of my mentors, in when she won in 1970, mm-hmm. she said to me, "How old are you?" I said, "I'm 16." She said, "You're going to win next time." And I said, "Okay, if Chantal says that, I'm going to work really hard." Mm-hmm. So we were talking about the program because she was presenting something about all the competitions. Okay, so I remember the Spohr variations. Mm-hmm. Because I remember that I thought I, in the first stage, it was and I remember I thought I played it badly, and I happened to see Suzanne McDonald in the hall. I didn't know her at that time at all. And she said, "Why are you crying?" I said, "Because it was terrible." She says, "Oh," and she couldn't speak to me really. but she said, "It was good." So that Hindemith, Britten Suite, Benjamin Britten Suite, Ravel Introduction Allegro, a piece. Oh, the contemporary piece that year was awful. It was so hard. Shidlovsky. And actually, some people just vetoed it, and so you didn't have to play it. But I had played many Israeli works along the way, Natras and Tal. So, Roussel Impromptu. Mm-hmm. Roussel, mm-hmm. I love this piece. And the fine Ravel Introduction Allegro and the Castelnuovo Tedesco concerto, concertino, which I just listened to the other day. I was maybe thinking of playing it somewhere this season, if this season happens. Mm-hmm. And I think they chose the Taillefer instead, Taillefer concertino. But I wanted to play the Castelnuovo Tedesco because when I played in Israel, it was a lot of pedals and fun, really great. I listened to it again, consequently. Mm-hmm. And when I listened to it, I thought, this is really good. It's really, Castelnuovo Tedesco was like a film score, Italian-American film score writer. But the orchestration is great. It's really wonderful. And so I revisited it after all these years. And I think someone should play it again. I think they should require it. And I remember because I went into the finals, there's some other repertoire I'm not remembering, but it was nothing like what you had to play or anyone else had to play in Indiana, at USA, or Israel. Now the program is, you know, at least a third, if not double, bigger. Mm-hmm. So maybe we had smaller brains then. But it was still difficult. And I remember the last stage. I was about to play, and my colleague and wonderful harpist and well-known teacher Joanne Turovsky, because we grew up together in different competitions. She was supporting me. She said, "Listen, if you can get through all those pedals, you're going to win this. You know, don't forget any of them." And it's a very chromatic piece. I'll never forget that. I was like, okay. She pumped me with the confidence that I had to make sure that I was solid. And the pedals were very chromatic. So there are a lot of them. And it's like each chord goes down a half step and then back up a half step and almost by three. So you're constantly moving. But it's very, and there's a lot of knocking on the board. I don't know if you've played that a lot.
I did. Required in the competition. Yeah.
It was?
Yeah, it was in 1989 in the first competition in the USA when I got the sixth prize.
Didn't you enjoy it?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, I love it now. I think it's great. And I think we should come up with an arrangement. This is another thought of something I have to do in the next 30 years that I have left on the planet. is to make a small arrangement with quartet, like Ravel arrangement of mm-hmm. of the Casanova Tedesco and the Taillefer concertino, mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. the Taillefer could be with a, like the quintet, cantet instrumental, the Mr. Grancini and Pierre Jamais group, mm-hmm. just flute and string trio, or maybe mm-hmm. string quartet and flute and harp for the so that we can play them more often, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. because there aren't enough symphony dates, you know, that are for anyway. So I'm so glad that you played it. I missed that. I forgot that it was required, but maybe it's time to bring it back.
Absolutely. I totally agree, because it is rarely played, and it's really something what should be played, because it's so fun. It's like another Spanish kind of music as a Rodrigo, so it should be played much more. Yeah.
And it's a joke, because he begins the first movement at copying the Debussy dances. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the first chords, he's making a joke about that. He was a good friend of Pearl Chertok's. She liked those mm-hmm. movie composers. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Indeed. And because you were saying that it's a lot of pedals, and as we heard at the first video today, that you are horsing, like riding the horse, and the feet and the pedals, does it really help you to make some kind of more structure when you ride the horses? Is it for you easier to push the pedals? Do you have some kind of pedals?
No, but not at all. Not because there are thousands of harpists out there that are better pedalers than me. My forte would be more my fingers, you know, and my head. But my pedals, the problem is I have to understand what I'm doing. I'm not someone that could just randomly move pedals. I could when I was younger, but now I have to know what chord, you know, where I'm playing. So I'm thinking more harmonically all the time. But but horseback riding, yes, the hand position, you keep your hands down low. Mm-hmm. Because a horse feels everything. The hand position is very similar to the heart position. So that's, but the feet are, it's more your entire leg. It's not so, it is intricate. The horse feels every movement of your foot too. You don't want to give him a wrong signal. But it can never be quite as embarrassing as the harp. You know, the harp is complicated, and all the young people that are learning it, I mean, it doesn't necessarily get easier. It's always there, that mathematical grid down at the bottom of the harp, and always keep it in your head. And I remember, Jana, I was reading finally something that made sense to me was Solange Renier. The niece, Solange, wrote in her method book about this, and she said you have to connect each pedal that you're moving to a note that you're playing. And that made so much sense to me, because I remember the first time I could learn scintillation, I was just moving my feet, you know, God help me. And now, and the Rhapsody too, and now I really have to know what the function of the pedal is mm-hmm. changing, because it's not so easy to remember things when you get older. So you have to sort of know what you're doing.
It's true that when we get older, and also, as you said, with the teaching, we find out more things that when we were younger, everything went so easily, and we were not thinking too much about anything. But now, as we want to also help the others, at least I am trying to think more. And it actually realized that I have to think also more when I am playing, actually, what I am doing. And with the pedals, it is the same thing. I'm always like feeling to find really the way that it will be easier to memorize the pedals, so that it will make the connection with the harmony or with the rhythm or with the exactly the note which you push. Yeah. And do any your kind of memorization for the pedals, only like the harmonies, or how do you do that?
These days, yeah. I mean, I would say if I had to play something, like one of the most difficult pedal things is Rodrigo Concerto, Concierto Sonata, not the mm-hmm. guitar concerto. Mm-hmm. And there are passages when I just have to trust that I know it. But I used to do that really well when I was young. My teacher would say, oh, you don't really know it, but you rise to the occasion. You could do it well when you're under pressure. But now I have to really, I also find that it's possible to be a little bit noisier when you're older. So I have to be very careful, because your body's not quite so flexible about getting mm-hmm. around the harp, and harps are noisy. They're noisy creatures that, mm-hmm. you know, so memorizing, I'm very organized. I don't believe in random pedals anymore. I think in what's mm-hmm. the chord, where I'm playing. The exception would be contemporary music, where you just have to follow the, but I'll tell you, when I heard I heard, Bridget Kibbe plays the Carter Barry Lodge fantastically, and she memorized it. Remember when she memorized it first, I was astounded. And then Catherine Siocci just played it from memory the other day, and I was like, I'm out of this. You know, this is for them. I can't memorize that, but I do remember having to memorize a piece of Joseph Tal in Israel for the Israel. I always learned the contemporary pieces because Pearl was very interested in contemporary music, and I had to memorize everything. And I remember it being easier to memorize randomly then. Now I'm a harmonic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And do you write all the information into your music, or you more are based on your memory, like to memorize?
I write it in. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't have as much time. I mean, now I've had time to actually practice, but usually in my schedule of raising a daughter, I was commuting 4 hours a day and playing in the orchestra and my summer is very busy. So I didn't have enough time to not be organized. I have to be organized about why, you know, but it's still a hard instrument. I didn't know, nobody can deny that. It's when I watch pianists play, or even I play the piano, I can play chords changes. And there's no extra noise. Mm-hmm. You don't have to tune it. If it's out of tune, it's not your fault. This is a beast. I mean, that's what I mean about wherever it is. Like the horse, it's a beast. But I love it. I mean, I've done it my whole life. And a day that I don't play the harp, a day in my week that I don't play, I really feel lost. Mm-hmm. And I know people who take time off. I've never, ever taken time off. Ever, ever. In my entire life. I'm just not that talented. I have to keep playing, and my fingers are, you're getting, you know, you can even see them on the camera. I've got arthritis, but that it's not painful, but I have to keep them moving. Sort of like when you get older, they say, keep moving, you know, keep playing. So you'll be the same shape forever, hopefully, for at least another 10 years.
It's fantastic how you play. So you don't need to be worried, but I understand also from my side that when I have holiday, for example, 1 week, I'm missing something, you know? I still feel like, something is missing. And then I come home and I start to play and I actually realize, yes, that's it. What is just part of our life. And I think that that's something what we just need to do, not that we have to, but we need to do to make our soul more happier all the time, because we are used to do it and we just do it with our passion, with our love. So that's, I totally understand that you cannot make any day off. And when you like so much horses, you are based in New York. There are no horses. How do you do it?
And yeah, so their horses right up the road.
Really?
These are stable, but they closed down for COVID. And I'm trying to get back in now. But my girlfriend also has her own horse up about 45 minutes away. But I ride in stables. My daughter, Claire, is a great horseback rider. She grew up riding 10 minutes from our house. We're not in the city. We're in the suburbs.
I see. And how often do you do that? How often do you go?
Right now, I'm not. Well, you know, when I was in Juilliard as a student, I rode when I was a kid. I took lessons all the time, and I rode in trail rides. In Colorado, in Aspen, I always would ride by myself. I knew the stable, and I could go up in the mountains myself. I was very brave. But then I went to Juilliard, and I would, in those days, in the 70s, you could still ride horses. And that's Claire's first birthday in Aspen. And I put her on a horse when she was one. that was on Aspen Mountain, on the ski mountain, actually. Yeah. I was convinced she would be a rider. She's a better rider than me. And when I was at Juilliard, we could still ride in Central Park. And before my classes or orchestra, I would save my money by not eating so that I could ride. And I would ride around the park, Central Park, by myself. Because I knew the stable, so I was allowed. And now it seems so dangerous, but I used to ride pretty fast around Central Park. You could go twice, two or three times around the park before orchestra.
Amazing. So now,
yeah.
But the hands, it's not tiring for you after to play the harp?
No. It probably was a dangerous thing to do, but I also, you know, I did a lot of dangerous things. I used to play I used to play squash a lot with a racket. Yeah, and that's dangerous. And then I used to ski. I learned to ski as an adult. I love that. And people say, be careful of your thumbs. But I never really worried about the worst mm-hmm. thing I ever did to my hands in my life was cut my thumb on a tomato.
Oh my God.
Yeah, I never did anything. So I think the more you worry about it, mm-hmm. but I will say, Jana, I'm sure I know you're, because you are amazing. I'm sure you're the same way, but I do protect my hands. And mm-hmm. sometimes the students will say, well, I'm not going to play for a few days. And I'm like, I can't believe that. So mm-hmm. I protect my hands by being consistent. So mm-hmm. even if I can't play, I will play mm-hmm. for 30 minutes or 45 minutes. And just brainless, or just that V-door exercise of Mr. Grangenis. I just do something, because I know that if I don't play, if I can't play, I will play better the next day if I've played a half an hour, even a half an hour, something, mm-hmm. But it might be just me. I also love to play, because not only spiritually, or mm-hmm. like you said, like what it does for you inside, and feeling not alone and like you're an orchestra by yourself. The other thing is that I feel like it's a massage for my hands. Mm-hmm. I feel really good. It's like someone mm-hmm. scratching my back. It's, you know, scratch. It feels so good on my hands mm-hmm. that I actually physically miss the feeling. Maybe if I was a baker and I could make some bread or pottery, it would be the same. But I really need to stretch them out all the time. So it feels good.
That's why also for the students, you can see by the playing that there is such a security, as I said already before. And that's what actually it's now proved, that Nancy is playing every day. That's what I really think, that it's important. Absolutely.
It's sort of pathetic. It's because I think people, you should go enjoy life too. But I believe me, I do. I mean, I have enough hobbies and things. Sure. But I do. I love to play. But I also, at this point, I'm just trying to maintain my ability a little bit at 60. You know, I'm at retirement age basically, and but I'm not going to retire. But I still am quite aware that I have to keep up with my students, who play amazingly every day and in class, and they come on the computer and play. And Eunice, who's watching today, you know, she's only 12 or 13, and she played the Norma, you know. For all of us on, you know, like, oh, you know, and then Miriam played, and Adam and Chai Yoon, and they all play so beautifully. So mm-hmm. it keeps you busy when you have to, when you teach this many really wonderful mm-hmm. people. You know, I mean, I learned so much from listening all these years to mm-hmm. the students. You know, I remember thinking, you know, things that Catherine would do, or Jessica Zhou in Boston when she played mm-hmm. things for me. My God, June Han was teaching all over the place. Emily Levine played something. She just plays so effortlessly, and she never worries mm-hmm. about it. If something mm-hmm. little thing goes wrong, she has an incredible focus. Even mm-hmm. people, I could name every student I ever taught right now in a line mm-hmm. if you wanted me to, from beginning to the end, but I won't, because it will take too long. But I remember something about each person and what mm-hmm. they gave to me, what they did particularly. And everyone is different, and mm-hmm. and I've been the benefactor of all of this much more than they have. You know, maybe I once in a while I'll hear a note that's wrong over an internet, and I'll say, I'm worth my money now. You know, but I've gained a lot more than the few notes I've fixed, or the mm-hmm. habits I've changed. You know, I feel like it's been an education the whole time, you know, even in Aspen, where I teach in the summer, mm-hmm. for 45 years I've been teaching there, 45 years, and I get to teach people that aren't my regular students, you mm-hmm. know. I've had fantastic people come through the festival, and they've sat next to me playing pieces like Gura Lieder of Schoenberg, or mm-hmm. Symphony Fantastique, or Mahler 2, Mahler 8. I've had many people, harpists around my country and your countries, the Europeans and Asia, come and play with me. And mm-hmm. it's been incredible education also to see how people play. And, you know, I could list all those names too, but it would go, someday I'll write a whole list of
people that I've know done. All your students are really fabulous. They are fantastic. So it's also pleasure, big pleasure for also you really to work with them. And the festival in Aspen is usually during the summer, isn't it?
We're having an online festival now. Unfortunately, it's not happening. But I'm doing a masterclass with three students. Ben Albertson from Seattle is a young student of Judy Lohman's, fabulous young talent. Phoebe Powell, who is a student also from Canada, and she's at New World Symphony, and Adam Fan, who's my present student at Juilliard, wonderful player. And we're doing a masterclass online. We're trying to figure out how to do it on the screen like this. But basically, no, the festival's not happening. But this this would have been my 44th summer. Wow. And the people that, I mean, Carol Thomas came to Aspen as my fellow, Carol Thomas, as my fellowship person. She's just like my sister, you know, she's my sister in the world of harp. And Marcel Cara came from Paris last year and knocked us, blew us away, played so beautifully. And so many harpists that aren't really my students, you know, that I can say I worked with them or I learned from them. Really, I learned from them, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's fantastic. Oh, I'm so touched about that to really see how wonderfully you are also attached to what your work. It's fantastic. Yeah. Can you go through the pictures now a little bit so that we also see what you sent us? Because this is your trio.
This is an older trio. That's Larry Dutton from the Emerson String Quartet on the left, Nadine Asen, who was a flutist at the Met, and myself. That's a long time ago, but there's my Horngacher.
Uh-huh. Indeed. And do you have also Horngachers in Juilliard, or do you teach on the Lions?
Lions.
Here is you. It's a beautiful picture also.
That's circa 1980. I don't know what I'm playing.
He showed already. This is a drummer. Which was your mentor?
Yep, that we're playing George Crumb, madrigals there, or something like that. Yeah, George Crumb.
This is your daughter on the horse, which we just shown now recently. And this is a nice picture.
Okay, so this is my cat Pan, who's not alive anymore. He was one of the loves of my life. Mm-hmm. And Pan sat by. I think we're gonna play the Gershwin later. Embraceable You.
Indeed.
Very, very difficult. And it's a piece that the pianist we met before, Will Healy, had played every day in my house. And Emily Levine was talking to me one day. She said, you know, it's easy to play on the harp. I said, easy? Nothing's easy. And she gave me the courage to do it. So Pan sat with me. You always sat on top of the harp while I learned Embraceable You. And when you hear it, you'll see how long it took to learn.
Oh my God. So we should really now post your video so that everybody can hear it. But did you put the cat on the harp by yourself, or she jumped up?
She climbed. Oh, I shouldn't tell that, but he climbs over the mechanism like that. up there while I play.
That's fantastic. So let's put now your beautiful play. And it's also interesting because it starts with the piece which we every harpist know.
So. Well, that was a joke because I just wanted to do it for this. And I actually play it without normally. It's an arrangement by Earl Wilde, the pianist, of Gershwin's famous song, Embraceable You. And I thought of it because everybody needs a hug right now because so many people are alone. So I thought, well, this is a good time. So I wanted to do something different for the harpist because I wanted to surprise them and not know it was coming. And I play the impromptu a lot, but I had to change key, obviously. Mm-hmm. So I edited it as an introduction. And the funny thing is I play this, only one person has heard this before. So this is sort of a first time. I sent it to Claire's father, who's a very discriminating, you know, I was married to him. He listened to my harp playing that's how he met me. But he was always very critical because he wanted it always to be perfect. And he loved my playing, but he listened to my recordings. So I sent this to him and he said to me, just recently, you know, during COVID, I said, what do you think? Is it good enough? And he said, it's beautiful. He said, but the only thing is that that introduction doesn't seem to have anything to do with the piece. He didn't know. And I said, wow, that's impressive. You have very good musical ears, because I didn't tell him. So the harpist will know right away. Enjoy it.
Indeed, let's go. Again, bravo. It's really fantastic. And yeah, you can see, and you played on the Lion and Healy, this one.
Uh-huh. That was when the Horngacker was locked up at the hall when we closed down. And so I was playing, and Yeah, it's a easier, fun. Yeah, that's Mr. Grangini's studio harp. It still has a voice.
It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. And the cat, which we were saying, was sitting on the top of the column when you were practicing that in the time. So just show it once more. Yeah. You have here one comment now. Maybe it's, yeah, it's again, like, big bravo to you, of course. And now let's go on for the photos. These are your students, probably.
Yeah, that's an Aspen class, but you can see Emily Levine in the back, mm-hmm. Emily Hoyle in the right, and Sophie Bear Daniel there, mm-hmm. and I'm trying to see who that is on the left. I can't see, and then me in the back, and there's someone else back there I don't recognize. But that was like somewhere in Aspen. We had just played mm-hmm. something. Yeah.
And here are also your students.
No. So this is my daughter in the middle, the smallest one, and my daughter. So I have another life that people don't know about. That's my daughter has three siblings, and these are like my stepchildren. Mm-hmm. Yeah, very close in age, and we're all very close to. We're very fond of each other. I just thought that was really cute because my daughter's the tiniest of all of them. Hugo's going to college, and the other two, they're French. Their mom is French, and their father's mm-hmm. Claire's father. The father mm-hmm. of my child, Jonathan. Yeah, so mm-hmm. they're just cute. That's Claire.
You mentioned that your ex-husband was musician as well.
Not at all, computers, but he plays the piano and he loves French music, and that's he heard me playing French music, so nice. He always encouraged Claire mm-hmm. being in music too. He plays mm-hmm. the piano. Mm-hmm.
So show once more your daughter. At this moment she plays cello, right? At the moment,
playing cello. She plays in Sarasota Orchestra much of the year. She's a mm-hmm. principal substitute there, and she mm-hmm. also does. She has a very active Instagram. She sings and plays and arranges, and she's ClaireMarie.cello. A lot of my students know her. She sings a lot of variety of things. She's very talented, and she plays piano too. And next week she has a meditation of the cello video coming out that the Aspen Festival hired her to do, mm-hmm. which is all beautiful. I play a lot behind her. I'm in the background on works by Arvo Pärt and John Cage, and something she wrote for us, a duo. But anyway, yeah.
That's fantastic. Can you tell me once more the her website, or so that I can write?
She's terrific. Yeah, yeah. Claire, C-L-A-I-R-E, C-L-A-I-R-E, Marie, M-A-R-I-E.
Together?
ClaireMarie. Yes, ClaireMarie.cello.
Cello.
Cello. That's her Instagram. Yeah, you'll see. She has YouTube.
It's not the website.
That's Instagram. She has on YouTube too. Claire Solomon cello.
Okay, so
she does all sorts of things. Yeah. She's talented.
Wonderful.
And that's her bird up top. That's Cuckoo.
Mm-hmm. It's really great. She's really talented. So now we have here. Also,
two of my most famous students and friends. Mm-hmm. They're my best friends in the world. And Jessica Zhou, who came to me at age 17 from Interlaken, from mm-hmm. Joan Holland was her teacher. She came from China. Mm-hmm. And she's now in the Boston Symphony, principal harp mm-hmm. on the left. And June Han, who came to me in Aspen as a young girl, and she babysat Claire. And now she's the teacher at Yale. At Peabody, she just got the position at Peabody Conservatory and Yale and Columbia University. And she played, both of them played a lot of second harp with me in the mm-hmm. Over the period before Jessica left. And now Jessica is a mom of two beautiful children.
Mm. Yeah. So actually, that's what's also my question. In the Philharmonic, you are the only one, or do you have, you are the only one harp, mm-hmm. and when you need a second, you can take the students from Juilliard?
Yeah, I usually wait for people to graduate. Mm-hmm. I really do wait for them. A few of them very seldomly have played while they're students, because mm-hmm. it's not a training orchestra position, it's not an academy, you know. But I know who can stand up to the pressure, because they mm-hmm. might play well, really great. They can probably play better than I can, but I need people not to be unflappable, to mm-hmm. people to under the pressure of Lauren Mazel or Alan Gilbert or Kurt Mazur was famous for being hard on substitutes, or Jaap van Zweden is an excellent musician and very, you know, tough on people. So I need people to be there. And June Han plays a lot with me now. And so does Stacey Shames. Stacey was my very first student and she's unflappable and great. But June and I have a joke when we're stressed about something, you know, and I always say, sit up. And we both go like this and we say, we're focusing. But I've had many, many other people play with me and people, and then they go on and get orchestra jobs like Allegra Lilly, who's now in St. Louis. And Catherine played. Catherine is my favorite, Dusli van der Erde harpist. She plays that part so beautifully. It's just sort of her part, because the second harp comes in with these beautiful arpeggios. And she's now in the Kansas City orchestra and a big position there. And Madeline Olson has not played with me, but she just got Buffalo Philharmonic. Mm-hmm. And Emily Levine played with me many, many times. And she's solid as they come. And she has now the Dallas Symphony. But then there are also young people like Charles Overton from Boston. He plays jazz too, great jazz player. And he and Ashley Jackson, who's from New York and teaching at Hunter College, they've played with me a lot. Many people. I really try to spread the opportunity because, you know, the best way to get over those nerves of, I remember Sivan Magen when he came to Juilliard and he was preparing something and maybe an orchestra excerpt audition or something like that. And he was playing the Bartok Concerto for Orchestra, and Sivan can play anything. He can play anything 10 times better than I can. And he's great. But he said to me, the first movement of the Bartok is you know, sola, very simple. And he said, suddenly this seems like the most difficult thing in the world to play. It was so funny to me because, you know, I said, really? You know, but the concept of having to do this tiny little motor skill at the right time with the right dynamic and please the conductor and also play with the winds is suddenly so challenging that I never overlook that talent. And one of the things I've noticed is that the American students are pretty well prepared for that because of our youth symphonies, and in London, in England, Great Britain, they're great youth symphonies, and all over the world. In you know, we have young orchestras now, and that's so important to play in an orchestra as a harpist, especially because you don't. I mean, I got to play an oboist in a good orchestra in high school orchestra, and I learned so much about. You could look straight at the conductor, and your music is right there, but it's totally different. So, I can have anyone I want, really. But June has played a lot. Bridget Kibbe's played with me a lot. Jacqueline Carrod. Many people.
Great opportunity. Wonderful opportunity.
Sivan played also. Yeah. This is one of my earliest classes when Claire was about, she looks 4 or 5. And there's Jessica Jo is there. I can't see who's sitting next to her. But Eric Nielsen is the taller boy. And Eric 1 second after Katrine Finch with Katrine Finch in Deauville years ago. He's a great harpist. He played with me a lot in the Philharmonic. He played a lot of Schoenberg and Zemlinsky with me. And Eric is now the conductor of the Bilbao, Spain. He was always a great pianist, and he was a double major on oboe. And he won the concerto competition and played the Strauss concerto. So I played last summer with him the Martin oboe and harp concerto, and Eric conducted. So I was supposed to be with Eric in Bilbao, Spain in November, but obviously that's been canceled. So Eric was there, he was just a kid. And Magali Carcelade is in Paris. She's a wonderful harpist, came to Juilliard at the same time, and now she's a mom with beautiful children. Yumiko Endo, who's down there in the front with Claire, Yumiko was Adam Fan's teacher. Yumiko came from Ayako Shinozaki also, and we trade our students with those we trust. I'm going to send some students to you, Jana. I like to send people away to get another opinion. So Ayako sent Yumiko, mm-hmm. and Yumiko sent Adam Fan, who's in my class now. So that's sort of fun. Then there's little Claire and Bridget Kibbe, the great Bridget in the front, who mm-hmm. came as also a 17-year-old at mm-hmm. Juilliard. And she was so cute and full of energy, as always. And now mm-hmm. she's also leading the way in her brilliant career. So. Mm.
And the girl who is in the back with the white shirt, isn't it Maria Casala?
She looked, no, Maria Casala was in it way, can you hear me okay?
Yes, I do.
Okay, she could, Maria Casala was in school just after me.
Oh, yeah.
Miss McDonald. This is Magali Carcelad. She's a mm-hmm. beautiful girl, and so is mm-hmm. Maria. But Magali is much younger, different generation. Mm-hmm. She's a mom now with three beautiful children. She just sent me a picture. I stay in touch with everybody too. That's what's fun. And Magali, would be much younger than mm-hmm. Maria.
Right. Only now saw that there is a year of
But they're both beautiful. They look like Sophia mm-hmm. Loren type. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. And here's the Isabel Perron.
There's my other harp sister, Isabel and Cadel. We are like a trio, like a group, and mm-hmm. we're very close. We share a lot of time together in the past, and mm-hmm. when we can, we always make dates to be together. And mm-hmm. that was Isabel was at my it was my recital, I think, the World Harp Congress or something like that. It was mm-hmm. in 93 or 4, something. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And here it's you when you are very little.
Mm-hmm. My thumbs are up. You can see that.
Yes. And how old have you been when you started?
I started when I was 7, and that mm-hmm. looks around 8. Mm-hmm. I probably played terribly, but I looked okay.
It was big, the harp, for you. So, yeah. And you started directly on that instrument.
That's why I know I was probably 8. Or just started mm-hmm. because I played on a smaller harp, but they took the picture with the old gold 22.
I see, mm-hmm. I see. And did you ever play the oboe after you started to play the harp, or you totally stopped?
I played the oboe until I was 18. Until I was 18, until college, and then I said this is enough. But I love playing it, yeah. But not as well. I took lessons and I did competition, the small state competitions and things. But mm-hmm. it just taught me something. It was important for me. There were people that were, mm-hmm. I went to one all state thing, and the boys next to me were so good on oboe. And I said, this is time for me to pack this instrument up. But I love what I learned from it.
Mm-hmm. But it's one of the most difficult woodwind instruments. So that you played oboe, it's really something very special because it's not easy. It's not a flute, which is, as the flute player said by themselves, that it's the easiest one. Yeah. But the oboe is really one of the most difficult.
Yeah. Eric Nielsen was a phenomenal, the conductor. He was a great oboe player and great pianist too. He plays scores and things. And Bridget Kibbe also played the oboe as a child. And, you know, I know Letizia Belmondo, she played, wonderful Letizia, she played the cello, and mm-hmm. she was, you know, both, and Sivan played piano. Catherine Ciocci was basically a great pianist. Mm-hmm. A lot of people...
Agne Clément is playing mm-hmm. the bassoon. Agne Clément is playing the bassoon and the harp.
Great talent, beautiful.
Yeah. Here is your another cat.
That's the other one. He just passed away, but he was the biggest. He was the king of our house. That's Romulus, and he liked to eat he was deaf. He couldn't hear anything, at all, ever. But he liked to watch Claire play the cello. He watched her bow, go, mm-hmm. and then he would like to bite. He liked to bite the strings because he could feel the vibration. But he sat with me many hours also.
That's lovely. Oh, do you still have cats now? Even you?
No. Now no. I do. I only have a bird who's loud.
The one which we have seen on the picture is your daughter, probably.
Yep, that's cuckoo. This is a recent. Mm-hmm. This is a recent class at Juilliard, 3 years ago. So Adam Fan, who is the student of Yumiko Endo's and me, mm-hmm. and Madeline Olson was her recital. She just won the Buffalo Symphony position. She took over for that was a joke. Madeline took over for Suzanne Thomas in Buffalo, and Suzanne won a top prize in Israel in 1976, and mm-hmm. she just retired And the other people in that picture are our students, Deanna Cirelli, she's in Juilliard. Katie Wong just graduated and she's working, she was working for Sony. Chai Yun Lee, he's from Singapore. Adam is of Vietnamese descent. And yeah, they're all in school, except for the two middle ones. Yeah. And the next picture you showed was a more recent class. So there's this, this Abigail Kent. She's a DMA, doctoral student. She's from Charleston. Yeah.
Wonderful player also. Wonderful player. And here you are with the Marco Salvi, the son of Victor Salvi.
I met Marco when he was a little boy, and I thought, except for Victor, I thought that Marco was the next most handsome man in the world. And then I met him all grown up, and I said, "It's true." He's and I'm very close with his sister, Nicoletta. We've been moms together, and I taught her daughter. I love the Salvis. They're a great family, and they all look alike.
The same, yeah. And he is with Mr. McDonald and Catherine Sochi,
and her brother. My brother Jeremiah, when he his piece won, that was in Indiana. Yeah, I was very lucky to be with Miss McDonald there. And also, you know, later my daughter went to Indiana to Jacob's school, and she won the cello competition, and she played Saint-Saëns concerto. And I got to sit with Miss McDonald at the concerto at the concert, and we had dinner before with Liz Hanen, and it was like a full circle. I said, Miss McDonald was coaching Claire. She didn't know she was my daughter. And she said, "There's Nancy in it, because she doesn't look like me." But so it was fun to be with Miss McDonald so many years later, listening to my daughter play.
Bravo, congratulations for this prize. It's fantastic. And here you are with another successful student of yours.
That's Lenka Petrovic. And I, she just sent me something she's working on yesterday, and I have to listen to it. She's something beautiful she recorded. We were so lucky to have Lenka at Juilliard, and they called her Queen Lenka of the Serbian Queen. My students loved her. She was from the moment she came into our school, and the moment she left, and she won the competition and came back still as humble as ever. As when she gave us more than you can imagine, just by being such a leader and being so calm and supportive of everyone, and never arrogant. Even when she won her prize, we had a big party for her, and she just is endlessly humble. And we made a lot of fun of her because she's so cute and she's so talented and she acts so innocent. But we always laugh because Lenka has so many talents, and she's so beautiful and tall, and she always jokes that she only eats meat and potatoes. So we would always feed her steaks. Whenever I see her, I think of this: how did she get to be so good eating just potatoes and steaks?
That's
great. What a great harpist, and the program she played her Israel program for us so many times, the different stages, and she worked, and she was in Aspen too. She came to Aspen as a special. On a special fellowship scholarship, she prepared all the chamber music in Israel and for Israel in Aspen too. So she had great colleagues to work with. Beautiful player.
Is she back to Serbia, or is she,
She has a job now in at Budapest. Yeah, she's playing with an orchestra, and I hope she's going to be doing lots of recording too.
Wonderful, super. That's really nice. Here's also your class with Lenka.
Yeah, and there's Clara Warford over on the in the blue shirt. She's from Nashville. Sort of the same. Yeah, that's when she came back. Serbian Queen, we called her. Serbian Queen. And she was amazing. And those decorations stayed up for 2 years.
And here's another from Aspen, probably.
Yeah, that was it. And there you see Catherine Ciotti on the right. Taylor Fleischman next to her, and you've seen the other ones. I'm forgetting names, but with it, Anna Dunlap in the back. This is Carlyanne Jones, Ellen Carlyanne Jones. She's a lovely harpist. She went to Yale. Noah Gabay, from Israel, and Dana Schneider is now going to law school. Yeah, she's on the right. Very smart girl. She went to Yale, and she's, but Noah's back in Israel, I think. And she was a beautiful player. She also came to Aspen on a special scholarship. And Taylor Fleischman down in the red, she's making all sorts of videos now. You'll see her. And of course, you know, Catherine and Katie Wong and Madeline. That's in Aspen. That's our campus.
It's a beautiful place, actually. It's really nice. And here's another group of people.
This is Eric Nielsen conducting the Martin oboe and harp concerto with Elaine DeVos. Is the harp is the oboist from the Met. She taught Eric the oboe, and I taught him the harp. And Jeff is a pianist who accompanied us in the rehearsal pianist. Yeah, great. That's in Aspen.
And here also.
There's Marcel Cara on the left. He's a student, a great student in the Paris Conservatory with Isabelle Moretti. And then there is, I'm trying to see, Phoebe Powell, me and Adam and Deanna. And then there's Abigail Ensel in the back, who is a wonderful, wonderful harpist who just said to me in a lesson, you know, I really want to do mountain rescue. And now she's doing some kind of mountain rescue. She lives in Colorado. Very strong girl. She runs about 10 miles a day and plays the harp just so beautifully. Yeah.
And you played in four harps in the orchestra, or it was
We play four and six and eight sometimes in Aspen because we can. Yeah, we play big works, and that was a Symphonie Fantastique, I think, or Mahler. I don't remember. We do so many big. We always double and triple and quadruple. The biggest being girl leader.
Yeah, this is the same. Yeah, and also this one.
This is the timpanist of the New York Philharmonic, Marcus Rotan, and we were just having fun after the concert.
And here's you.
Yeah.
And somewhere. Here, that's also a picture of, it was lovely.
Jana. I found that in my file. I couldn't believe it. And Judy Lohman. Yeah, and that was at Jacobs at the USA competition. Yeah, I was so excited. Yeah, that was the second time I've met you.
And this is
Jessica Show from Boston Symphony.
And here is also a group of your students.
There's the only one you haven't seen yet is Miriam Roof on the left, who was a top prize winner at USA, and now she's in Juilliard.
And here is some private photo.
That's my daughter. We were hiking. That's her grandfather. Her grandfather was a Shakespeare scholar and sort of a character. And he came and met us in Colorado and took Claire on one of her first hikes.
So it's the father of your ex-husband.
Yes. Yes.
And he was also not a musician.
No, he was a Shakespeare scholar, and he would recite every Shakespearean line ever written in any play from memory. He was amazing.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, my. And this is you.
I was a cheerleader. I hate to admit it, but I was a real normal girl. And yeah, I was a cheerleader. Made me very popular, much more than playing the harp.
Beautiful. Really beautiful. Here's another group of your students.
These are people that, Alexis Kollner is on the right, Ali Kollner. She was a student of Joanne Turovsky's before she came to me. Chloe Tula in the middle had just played a concert. And she was at New World, and she was a student of at Rice University with the teacher. Oh, I'm calling too many names today, but that's in Aspen after she played. Yeah, she's beautiful.
And we have just one comment which I would like to bring in, because it's from Paulina. She wrote that she remembers so much to meet
you. She was playing beautiful music in the restaurant or the lobby. I think is that the right Paulina? And she's beautiful. I just met her that time. How nice.
And now
she wasn't playing in the restaurant. I'm sorry, she was just a lovely harpist. She wasn't playing. That was another country.
I think that this is the very similar what we had before, and this is also more
the same.
And here is another one.
Yeah, that's one of our Wagner groups. That's Stacey Shames in the back on the left, my first student, Ashley Jackson, who is wonderful, Emily Levine, and June Hans over on the right. Yeah, there, and Alexis Kohlner. Yeah, so that's a Philharmonic. There's a very famous soprano. We had just finished Wagner. Yeah.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And another picture, and there is
Emmanuel always has given us several fantastic masterclasses, and he's very wonderful. He always plays a lot in the classes, so it's really inspiring. And Lenka was there, and then the woman in the front. Oh, and Allie Grant over on the left was my former student. She's at Cincinnati getting an advanced degree now with Gillian Bennett. Gillian Bennett, who's the harpist with Cincinnati. Dorella Myrescu, who lives in New York, she was in my class with Grosjeany. I hadn't seen her in years. She just came. Yeah. Oh. She's from Romania, I think.
And you can maybe tell us a little bit about Marcel Grosjeany, as you were the last student of his. He was married, as you said. He didn't have any children, right?
Yes. In fact, you know, he did have a son, Bernard. And just last week, the American Harp Society chapter in New Jersey had a masterclass, like a discussion with Bernard, and he was the guest. So I went to that just to listen to Bernard. He did civil service. I mean, he worked for the Red Cross. He never played the harp, but he talked a lot about his father. He was at all the lessons. They all spoke French, and his mother Georgette was a singer, but she stopped her career when she married Mr. Grosjeany, and they lived in a beautiful apartment right near Juilliard. But his son was, you know, I think that Mr. Grosjeany was such a quiet man. You know, he never talked much about his son, but his son was always there listening. Mm-hmm. And his son, Bernard, knows all the repertoire. He comes to every concert at Juilliard still. And he always loves it, of course, when we play the Rhapsody or the Aria. But he appreciates modern music, too. But he loves to have the Children's Hour or the Garden of Charm and Enchantment, anything that his father did. He's very supportive. He remembers all the students' names, and he gave a beautiful class and memoirs of memoirs of his father. Mm-hmm. But he's older now, and but he loves the harp. It's surprising he didn't play ever.
Yeah, that's very pity. And did you ever heard, because as you were studying with Mr. Grosjeany only 3 years, did you hear him play a recital, or did he not play anymore?
He played I was young. He played his last recital in 1969. I lived far from New York. I should have been there. I was just sort of, I don't know, we were living life. And I didn't, I would have been 2 hours to get there. And Pearl told me, he played his final recital. And the last thing on the program, he said, someone give me, for an encore, he said, someone give me a tune, a melody, and I'll improvise on it. Yeah. So I wish I had been there, but I didn't. I did listen to his videos, and teaching videos, and he played a little bit in lessons, but he had broken his shoulder by the time I studied. After his shoulder broke, he had a hard time getting back to playing. But he would show me different little things on playing, but mostly it was talking. And and he talked a lot about, he showed about how to press the string. He was very much in his philosophy was pressing the string. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And pressing more and holding on, as you say, and then releasing. And he had big hands, and he was really into the string, very much into the string. Mm-hmm. So that's the concept that I learned from him, was more rather than just being on the string, but learning to be into the string and sort of wrapping your fingers more around the strings, but allowing the pressure to push the sound, you know, to make the sound buoyant. That's what I learned from him.
Mm-hmm. That's what I can feel from your playing. And I saw that maybe when I saw some of the videos of Grosjeany, that it was very similar the way how you do. So that's really fantastic. It's really great. And do you know which piece he liked the best? Do you remember? Oops. I think that we lost Nancy. You are now out of mic. You have to put the mic out of its mute. You're mute. You have to, there is a mic on your, you just have to push it on the computer. It just, there is a mic, it's mute. You can just put it on, push it on the computer. It's there. It's next to your, on the picture. It's, yeah. Maybe you can, we cannot hear you now at the moment, but I hope. Yes, now.
Yes.
Yes, now it is okay. Yeah. And Nancy, do you know which piece he, like a composition he liked the best?
Mr. Grangeny? You know, he liked organ composers. He loved César Franck. César Franck. Yeah. And of course he loved all the French music. He loved Ravel and Debussy. But he liked César Franck and he liked Vidor. And you know, he wasn't so much into modern music. The Hindemith Sonata, remember, was very modern for him. Mm-hmm. The Hindemith. Mm-hmm. And when Vincent Persichetti wrote the serenades for flute and harp, he was teaching at Juilliard, and Mr. Grangeny brought this to me as some big modern work, you know. it wasn't that modern, but Mr. Grangeny loved Couperin and Rameau. He loved the old harpsichord players, and he transcribed a lot of things. In fact, I didn't have enough time. I would have recorded. I'm recording a lot of Couperin and Rameau, and one of the pieces that Mr. Grangeny loved was like Sœur Monique, the little harpsichord piece with all the trills. He loved pieces like that, about intricate things, attention to details. Yeah. I've always played that. Jane Wydenstall made me learn that, but I love listening to, he transcribed La Camaris and some Decan, all those beautiful pieces that fit so beautifully on the harp. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, but he loved French music. Obviously,
of course, yeah.
And he did love his own music. He did love his own music.
Mm-hmm. And he did a lot of music, not only transcribed, but he also composed so many of them, and they are really beautiful and very much played and very known in the harp world. And Nancy, what is your plan now after all this COVID and everything finished? Is there any plan or any your future dream which you would like to do? Except that you said that you want to go to the things from the past that you want to collect and you want to publish. Is there any other plan?
Yeah, well, yeah. Actually, you know, I called my, I have a person who's recorded me before a lot, and it's not a company, but he's a wonderful, he's a famous recording producer, and he just recorded Trifonoff and Joshua Bell. And I just called him, I said, are you recording now? Because I can just go in a room, because I said, I have all this stuff in my hands and I have to get it out. I'm ready to get it out because I'm ready. And so actually we're actually recording in the next month or two, a lot of things. So I have to move on. I have other transcriptions that are coming. That's one thing. The Philharmonic won't play until January at least. But my students are very busy, and I'm still seeing them now, and so I'm keeping busy with that. And in the future, I don't like to travel so much anymore. I don't love to go far distances. Like, but sometimes for the orchestra, I have to. But the most important thing to me is to record. Because recording came to a halt when the CD came out, and there was too much. And then the CD stopped, and now it's online, and I can't figure the computer out like you can. But that's really important. I have so much that we didn't release that was recorded. Like I have a foray in Hindemith, but I'll do them again. Mm-hmm. Anything that I know, just because you only live once, and it's not. It's a lot of repertoire that's ready to go. So that's my plan, and the folk songs that I want to get things published, and that's mostly. And I want to live more. I want to ride horses more, and I want to have more time to, God willing, be a grandma. And I already feel like a grandma. I'm I'm sending and getting pictures from all my students who have getting married or having babies and having, you know, children graduate from college. So it's, you feel like you've been a grandmother 100 times over, but I want to be, I want like everybody, all of us to stay healthy and have long careers like Marisa Robles, you know, or like Grosheny had such a long career. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I wish for everybody to wash their hands when they're playing the harp, because in our harp studios, we have to be careful. We always had to be careful of colds and everything. But as I told you, I did survive the virus. I had it for 8 days. And it was not fun, but I was never afraid that I was not going to be able to practice the next day. You know, I did practice actually, Jana, I did. I dragged myself up just to do that 30 minutes, but I survived. So I have those strong antibodies and I'm ready to go. But I want everybody to know that I'm sure some people out there also had it, that there is a future. And I'm looking forward to hearing the recitals. Every student of mine has to come back with a 45-minute recital in whenever we're together again. That's their assignment. And I'm looking forward to hearing everyone play. The joy for me is listening to other people play. I love listening to Jana, to you play. It just makes me practice more. But also what I like about your playing in particular is the you just sit down and play. There's no mess. There's no worry. And just music comes out. And that to me is the way that everyone should play, should make music. Of course, we all can't because we all get nervous or get tight. But Jana always just sits down in the middle of the party and plays her heart out. And that's a big, yeah, true. It's true. I've seen it. And so I want all the harpists to realize that we will have a performing future. We will. And, but it's also important to take care of yourself and take care of your hands and your body. And for me, the most important thing is to be relaxed mm-hmm. and to play well, to play healthy, not to mm-hmm. play with your shoulders, not to play with your back, not to play with your arms, you know, but to let your fingers do the work mm-hmm. and let the music just enjoy it and to love your playing. That's what I want for the future. I want to grow old and, I'm old. I mean, I'm 65, but I feel like a high school student still. But I want to grow old to be able to tell the younger harpists how much I like their playing, because that's mm-hmm. what I love more. You know, because when I was young, people were very reserved and they would say, fine, you know, fine performance. But I want to say, you know, you rocked or you nailed it. Or I want people to understand that even if they don't win in Bloomington or Israel, that I love their playing, you know, that just, it's wonderful to win that prize and you can use it as a medal. I was a Girl Scout and you collected badges of what you did. It's wonderful. It's great. But there are many people out there, many composers that don't win, artists and harpists, and you have to believe in yourself and believe it. Believe me, if I hear you, I'll tell you what I think. And it's usually positive because I always see potential mm-hmm. when I see people. I see potential in everything they're doing. I'm not a very good judge, Jana. I'm not a very good judge on these panels because, you know, I'll listen to someone and someone else will say, well, it wasn't perfect, but I'm like, but you know, it was wonderful. It touched me, and they have. I love looking at the people that don't pass and they should know that it's not just about, I mean, it's wonderful. We love having first prizes and second prizes and third prizes and all the way down, right? It's wonderful. It helps and it makes it easier, but it doesn't make us better, not much better. It just means we have to work harder, but as hard. Yeah, but I really do. I look forward to hearing all the young people. I'm amazed by the young talents coming up and I like to see what they do on their own.
But Nancy, I can assure you that you have been always an inspiration for many of us and really big idol. So you are just humble and I just want to tell you that I really admire you and you are really wonderful, absolutely one of the best for me. And I am really very proud that I got to see you, meet you, and that we had the time also today to talk. And I have here also, it was our also a last time meeting. It was the second time, as you said, today is the third time. The first time it was in 1993 when I had the recital in Lincoln Center in New York. So it has been so long time since that. And now I'm so happy and proud that you had time for us to be for 3 hours, even more than 3 hours, 3 hours and 15 minutes almost.
Oh my, wow, time. I'm going to take you to lunch now. Can we go to lunch now?
I wish to jump immediately to you and to go for lunch. And I wish that we have time and able to meet in person soon, because it's really wonderful to talk to you. You are just great, not only fantastic harpist, but mainly also wonderful human being. So I thank you so much for all your time and all your really wonderful stories, wonderful advices. And I'm sure
thank
that
you. Oh my God.
We have so many wonderful comments here also. Marisa Robles was here again mentioning that she's very, very happy about everything, and he's really nice. All the really again, it was here, it's also written, it was long, but it has been great. So really, thank you so much for everybody. I think that there is so many wonderful comments, and I don't want to miss any, but of course I think that everybody will be able to listen the recording again and the interview, and of course read all the comments from the archive, which is going to be not only on the Facebook but on the YouTube. And we have wonderful videos, wonderful recordings, and I will, after we will finish our interview, I will post the whole recital, which was now cut into the parts, but I will now post it for you so that you can, in a very peaceful time in the evening or morning or in the lunchtime, you can listen to it and be still with Nancy Ellen, our wonderful, wonderful star of today's interview. And I'm so, again,
thank you.
I wish you all my thank best. You. And of course, I would like to very much to also to say goodbye by a piece, which is, of course, played by our guest today. It's a Iber. And you can maybe only say a little bit about it before we will finish with the music.
You know, well, the Iber is, everybody knows the Iber, and we all learn it. Many of us learn it when we're young. And I'm looking at Veronica Lemonchenko. She's so famous. I'm intimidated. And Jan, you're so famous. I'm looking at these names. Thank you for coming. And thank you for taking part of your day, because I know that even though we're all at home, we have so much to do. But the scherzo I've loved all my life, and I didn't play it since I was maybe 10 years old. But I just find it's a lot of fun. It, to me, it's like a little puzzle of fingers, and it's happy. It's just happy music, and that's what we all need, is a little happy spirit in our playing and in our listening and in our lives, and we'll all see each other again. And stay healthy and safe. And Jana, bless you. You're wonderful. Thank you for doing this for all of us. For all of us. It's amazing. I have to send you something enormous.
You gave us a lot by your time, and I'm so pleased that you were with us. Take care, really, a lot, and good health to everybody. Bye-bye, dear. All my best.